Go. Hey everybody, it's Jeff Lafferty, and it is Art Challenge night. We got to figure out a name for this. Anyway, I'm here with a bunch of guys, and we're going to do an art challenge and have some fun. So I'm here with Peter Palmiotti.
Hello, all.
I'm supposed to say hi, Peter.
Okay. Hi, Peter.
Starting out good. I'm also here with my good buddy, Mike Fleming Jr., back from the grave.
Salutations, everyone.
He's been living out there in the Arizona desert, eating javelinas. And we also got Brad Ashford back from last week.
Yep, back.
I don't feel like I'm the only one excited for this.
All right. No, I'm excited.
All right, cool. So anyway, we're going to do the mashup challenge that we did last week, where we took a couple characters suggestions from the chat and mashed them together. So last week we did Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and Lobo. Yeah. And then we tried to draw it in a couple hours. And I invite you guys in the chat if you guys want to join in, draw something, and then send it to me on Facebook or Twitter, and I'll show them at the end of the show. So that's what we're doing here. And Pete was telling a great story about hangouts on the phone. So what were you saying there, Pete?
I did a hangout a while back, and I went into my Google page afterwards, and I could swear I accidentally called 100 people.
Accidentally called what?
Somehow, I like, instead of inviting people to the hangout normally, I somehow accidentally called 100 people into a conversation.
Yeah.
So apologies to everyone. I don't know. I don't know what happened. I just dropped myself out of the call. I was like, I didn't know what was going on.
100 people showed up and then you took off. They're like, who set this up? That's hilarious. So I noticed there's a ton of people. Pencil for Life, Animate Clay, Mark Spass is here. Hey Mark, how's it going? Gazbot's here. Hey, you know, actually, if Gazbot, if you want to join in on this, I don't know if you feel like doing some crazy drawing for a couple hours, but you're welcome to come on. Just let me know. And Mark, too, if you want to, actually. Yeah. Both of you guys are invited.
Yeah, Mark, come on, man.
And if there's any other artists out there lurking here at the beginning that want to jump on, that I kind of know, you know.
In the chat, I think.
Yeah, just throw it out in the chat and I'll see. So, but anyway, we need two characters to mash together and do as a challenge. So what do you guys think? What do you guys think in the chat? Throw out some characters that you'd like, or if you have an idea of two characters mashed together, throw that out too. So how's things going for you guys? Brad, I noticed you're IndieGoGo
disappeared. Yeah,
amazingly, yeah, you refunded my monies, which I was completely shocked. I was almost angered by that because I wasn't gonna get my book. So what's up with that?
No, you're gonna get your book. we were not gonna be anywhere near 50% by the end of the day. So 50%, I probably would have still kind of soldiered on. But after talking with John Malin and a couple of the other guys late last night, I decided to pull it down, even though it hurts me financially to look at it, but to pull it down, revamp it, come back with stronger, ready to go campaign. So it just took me way too long to network and get to know everybody and get my name out there than I thought it was going to take. And 60 days was nowhere near enough. So yeah, but yeah. Okay. So I said, I'm sorry, I'm going to refund everybody. And I know some people do keep the money, I guess, and still honor it later on, but I didn't want to be tempted with keeping someone else's money and maybe spending it. So, you know, I was like, so one by one, I just refunded everybody, all 54 backers at the time. So the hardest thing I did, I was like, oh, refund. but I think it was a necessary thing to do. Yeah. So,
yeah, I think that's the thing. Yeah. When you have the flexible funding, mm-hmm. that's kind of why I didn't set up the flexible funding too. Cause I was like, if I don't get the money, you know, it's like, I'm not going to be able to do what I need to do.
Yeah,
so,
even at 50% though, I could have printed at least 1,000 books for me, you know, right. And that would be good. But yeah, there's just, I wasn't going to get close. And I, even though I was picking up steam at the end, it wasn't going to be there. I just had to face the reality. So,
okay. Yeah.
But I'm going to come back swinging. So, yeah.
What was your book about?
It was about a hitman from a Mexican cartel who got out, but then was kind of forced to go back in to deal with a bunch of evil people. But he couldn't use guns. He only could use tools.
Against a Mexican cartel?
Yep.
Wow, that sounds interesting.
Yeah, it'll be fun.
Are you done with the book then?
So the script's done. I'm just doing all the artwork right now. So. Okay.
Cool.
Yeah. In between finishing commissions for people. So,
are you doing that 100 day challenge?
No.
Do you ever plan on doing that?
No. I draw every day anyway. It's like Inktober. You do Inktober. I'm like, hell no. I draw, you know, I don't know how many hours a day anyway. I don't need to. I think Inktober is kind of for, how did I put this the other day? People who.
You're ready to be offended.
Yeah.
People who what do you call it?
You think this would be such a hot topic issue?
Well, it's for people who procrastinate a lot. So, you know.
Well, maybe I don't know about that. I mean, it seems like a good way to like document and like hold yourself, you know, to the fire and you know, like daily updates and getting motivation and
gotcha. Yeah, some of my pieces are like, I don't want to waste time drawing for like 2 hours here and then, you know, whatever. So,
yeah, that's
what I'm working on. Right.
We're going, Pete. Sorry.
I'm working on my Inktober piece right now.
Oh, okay.
Sorry, bro.
So, we got some stuff in the chat so far. We got the sorceress from He-Man, the Death Dealer and Fritz the Cat, I guess mixed together.
Ooh. No,
yeah, that's interesting. Nova and Green Lantern. Somebody threw out Harley Quinn. Somebody said He-Man and Lion-O.
Oh, that might be cool.
I'd have to. Lion-O. Oh, that's the Thundercats one.
Yeah,
right?
Thundercats. Yeah.
Huh.
Judge Dredd and Venom. Interesting.
Well, now that sounds kind of cool. I don't know about you guys, but
did you guys hear the news? I just seen it just a few minutes ago.
Bill Kavanaugh
says,
"No, it's not about that."
Just making sure.
It was about Will Vinton. He passed away today. Did you guys hear about that?
Oh man, you're kidding me.
Yeah, 70 years old.
Wow. Will Vinton's the you know, like the claymation guy, did like the raisins and all that kind of stuff for you guys that are non-stop mo people.
Oh yeah,
it's pretty wild, man. I didn't know he was all that old. So
yeah, he's 70. He looked good for his age, but I don't know exactly. I know he was battling some disease, but I don't know if that's what got him or what. But
yeah,
definitely. Definitely sad for stop motion fans for sure.
Yeah, that's too bad. So, yeah, I'll read more about that later. So we got Deckard from Blade Runner and a cowboy. And so play throughout Superman, Cowboy Deckard.
I'm interested in Judge Dredd because he's not a common superhero. I like him a lot. We can do Judge Dredd and maybe Sorceress from He-Man.
The sorceress. He's a sorceress from He-Man. He's not the little guy with the scarf, is he?
Oh, no, no, there's the evil sorceress too. Evil-in? I think Evil-in? Yeah. So there's the good sorceress and the bad sorceress. So.
Okay, so you cool with Judge Dredd, Mike, for one side of it?
Yeah, I don't care.
What do you think, Pete? I like the idea of Judge Dredd. That sounds kind of good.
Yeah, Dredd's good.
So then what are we going for on the other side? Let me look up Evil Sorceress on He-Man.
Judge Dredd and Arco. That's funny.
I don't think anybody will get it if we do that one. No. I don't even recognize this character.
Yeah. Judge Dredd and Superman. I am the alien law.
What about, like, Judge Dredd and the Jetsons or something like that? Does it have to be
Skeletor might be good. Judge Dredd and Skeletor. Or the Phantom. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, they were throwing out the Phantom last week.
Yeah.
I actually kind of like that. Judge Dredd and Skeletor. That might be kind of cool.
Yeah.
What do you guys think about that?
Let me look up Skeletor. What is that?
He is the skull head. Yeah. From He-Man.
And Gazbot says that's just Judge Dredd. Judge Death. That is kind of true.
Yeah. How about Death Dealer and Judge Dredd?
Somebody threw out the Gunslinger Dark Tower too. What was it? What did you say, Pete? I'm sorry.
The Death Dealer and Judge Dredd. So Frank Frazetta's character.
Yeah.
Could be an interesting combo.
I kind of like that idea.
I'm down.
Okay.
Let me pull up some reference material.
What do you think, Mike?
I'm looking these guys up. I know Death Dealer.
You don't know I am the law?
Personally?
Yeah. He lives down the street from me.
Who is the other one? What's the other one? Judge Dredd?
Yeah.
I know who he is.
Yeah.
I love the Carl Urban version. That's my favorite one so far for the movies.
What, not Stallone?
Stallone's is over the top, but yeah.
It was fun at the time.
It's true, it was. I just watched it. I'm amazed he got two movies that Judge Dredd.
Yeah. You gotta give him that.
Mm-hmm. So is there any, like, what's the rules to this whole challenge? I didn't see your guys' last
The rules are 2 hours. You got to mash these two characters together and make it better than everybody else. No, I mean, it's just, that's about it. It's just a 2-hour time limit. You know, you can do like whatever you want. You want to do a bust or something, or, just a part of him, or, but it's just kind of a mashup of these two characters, however you see it.
A mashup of two masked men.
Well, then it means it's all going to be in the mask. So,
yeah, I mean, they are kind of similar, but I don't know. I think I can make a cool picture out of it. I sold that Lobo Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle, so I'm looking forward to selling it.
Oh, man.
We start throwing in the Jetsons there. I don't know if I can sell that. Let's see. Somebody said just look up Molly Hatchet. And then they're throwing out the Phantom again. The Phantom and Judge Dredd might look like the Berserkonaut. I'm not sure I want to do that one. Let's see. Aliens versus Garfield.
That might be interesting. So I'm on Team Judge Dredd. Sure.
I'm definitely for Judge Dredd. What would be different than Judge Dredd that we could like mix him with? The Judge Dredd Samurai or something, or Judge Dredd. I mean, I actually liked the Death Dealer because I
Judge
I
Dredd got Yusaki cool in my... Ojimbo.
The Rabbit Judge Dredd. How about that, dude? Mike. What? You know who that is? That
the rabbit?
Yeah, Yosaki Yojimbo. Who's the artist?
I forget.
I don't remember. But he's a samurai rabbit.
Yeah.
Well, I'll just look him up. What is he called?
Spell it, Pete. Yosaji Yojimbo. Yeah, let's put it in the chat. We can't remember who this guy is.
Yusagi.
Oh, Stan Sakai. Yeah, you probably wrote that before.
Yeah, Stan Sakai.
What is it? Can you spell it?
S-T-A-N, and then his last name is S-A-K-I. And then just put, like, rabbit comic, and it'll come up.
It's a Dark Horse comic, if that helps.
It's in the chat right now, if you look over at the chat. I don't know if you got that window open.
I found him. Thanks for the spelling it out.
Okay.
He's kind of cool looking. So we're going to do him and who else?
Judge Dredd.
This guy and Judge Dredd, huh? So no Death Dealer now.
No.
I'm looking up horse pictures.
All right. Are we good with this?
I'm good with it.
Is this the challenge? All right.
I'm just pulling up my reference.
Yeah. And
Stuff.
Okay. I also wanted to say again, last week there was guys who drew in the chat with us. And here's somebody I really want to join in this. Justin Martin, are you an actual artist, dude? I've never seen you in here before, so I got to be a little bit cautious because I've let other people in sometimes and it turns into like a whole deal. But anyway, the people in the chat, if they want to draw along, and then when we get down to the end, you guys can send me your links, you know, as long as you can get it on the computer somewhere, and I'll screen share and show your work off along with ours. So it was a lot of fun last week. So if anybody wants to do that, feel free to jump in. And okay, so I'll go ahead and grab a timer. Let's see. Cool. All right. So we all ready to tackle this? Is everybody going silent, reaching for their paper?
Yeah.
All right, cool. So somebody start talking about something. We don't want just dead air for...
That is true.
10 minutes while everybody thinks up an idea. Let me try to think. Hold on a second. I got to flip my camera.
Did I tell you about the time I called 150 people? Yeah.
Well, Pete, man, remember that time, like, way back when we were first doing the Artcast? And we stuck the link into the show, like, in the chat? We had all those kids show up.
Yeah, that was fun. Yeah, we got all these kids started showing up into the stream.
I know. There was just like, I mean, they were coming as fast as you could get rid of them. And they were all like acting weird. They were like, I mean, I don't know what. They instantly were like dressing up in costumes. And it was just the craziest thing I've ever seen. Tommy, never do that again.
All right, so is one of the rules they have to be the same character, or is that what kind of the rule is?
No, you mash them up.
Okay, so it has to be one character though. It can't be them versus each other or anything.
Correct.
Yeah, they if they're combined characters. If that's what you guys said. So in the chat, somebody it says message retracted. I wonder what that means.
Yeah, someone deleted it.
You can actually delete your messages out of the chat board? I didn't know that. That's interesting. It's pretty wild. Cool. All right. A piece of paper. So what's everybody been doing this week? Getting a lot of work done out?
Finishing off those commissions I owe people, so.
Doing a bunch of commissions, yeah.
Yeah. Like, I finished off that Vision the other day, finally.
But yeah, so that was a nice one. I like that a lot.
Thanks, bro.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I've never had anybody ask me to do the Vision, the commission. That's one that I haven't got yet.
Yeah, it was a buddy of mine here. He was doing it for his dad's birthday. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it was fun. It's the second time I think I've done them. Yeah. The only one I really got once was Warlock. I've only done him once.
Yeah.
Adam Warlock.
Yeah, he's a little different kind of character. You don't see him as much, so.
No, you don't.
Let's see. So Judge Dredd. Let me go through this again. This is when I really can't stop. I end up stop looking at the chat once I start looking at the reference. My windows start layering over top of each other.
Yeah.
So
we're competing against the Artcasts, you know.
What, tonight? They're on Wednesday nights, aren't they?
Well, it changes depending on their schedule.
That's freaking crazy. What are those guys doing? They know that I ran this show last week, so now Thursday's my night.
They didn't get the memo.
I totally didn't know that. Whose channel is it on this tonight?
I think it's probably Joshua, because they switch back and forth.
Right.
I mean, it's either Josh or Scott.
Let me go look. I want to see who's on. Well, Chris is going to be on there.
Yeah, that's right. Chris McLennan.
The second one. Well, we should have just crashed their show.
Get the link and just walk right in.
What would that look like?
Yeah.
You're showing the Artcast together. Let's draw that.
Pretty much look the same because that's all it is. It's just the same show. Yeah. Alright, let me do a stretch of this dude. Yeah.
And I have like pretty limited knowledge about Judge Dredd and absolutely no knowledge about this rabbit fella.
He's a samurai. You know what samurai is.
Well, I mean, that's what he does. I'm not sure who he is, though.
And he's a rabbit samurai. Dredd is just a future cop.
Right.
To the extreme.
Yeah, I just bought a couple of Yosaji Jimbo comics for Tristan up at the comic shop like a couple weeks ago.
Cool.
He's kind of was into them, like the cartoony style. They were fun to read.
I don't think I ever read it. I had plenty of copies of the book at some point, but
I was surprised they're still going. I mean, this comic has been going a long freaking time.
So does it have to be both characters like as one, or can it be like the rabbit in the guy's suit, or
what? Yeah, that's a mashup.
Okay, so it doesn't have to be like half man, half rabbit.
Yeah, I mean, whatever your vision tells you.
Well, I just don't want to go outside the rules, and at the end, we're like, oh well, you went outside
the rules. You're disqualified. Get out the show. I mean, how am I going to do this with this helmet over this rabbit? This was the horrible idea. We had the death dealer, and then we went for this. What the hell happened?
It could have been cool, but no.
Let's see. Yeah. I wonder how Chris's book's doing on Kickstarter. I think it was about halfway when he was on my show earlier this week. So hopefully it's getting funded.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it was definitely more than 60% or around 60% maybe.
Okay, I'm just going to go for it. Yeah.
I know, I shared it out a bunch of times.
Yeah. I really didn't know that it was going, though. Which is, it's getting scary on Facebook, like what is going by that I'm not even seeing. I mean, I'm just wondering if Facebook's just not worth it anymore, because there's just been a lot of stuff that, man, I don't even see, you know? Like, I mean, me and him, I don't comment that much and see his stuff that much, but it's like, I feel like we're kind of in the same group a little bit and stuff. You know, why in the hell aren't they showing me his stuff, you know?
I don't know. Like, it's probably at least a year ago it started going in that direction for me, that really I see the top two or three people max, unless I go to groups and see posts there, or I go directly to the people's pages and see what they're up to.
Right.
But everything gets completely lost now. And it's like, you know, it's a job. It's a job to go around and see what's happening.
Yeah, it's because they want to get you engaged.
I don't have time.
Yeah, I get you.
That's why, yeah, you follow somebody on Facebook just so that their shit will show up with you and not you have to do anything. So, it's crazy.
Yeah. Well, it's like everywhere. I mean, you know, it's like I don't see people's YouTube stuff pop up unless I go there.
Yeah, that's what I really don't get YouTube's thing with that, because I would just think it's got to be hurting their overall, you know, just views for everyone by not just sending out the emails like they used to. Because it's like I miss like so much stuff now.
Let me ask you something. Notifications. You hit the bell. Yeah. Where's it supposed to pop up?
You'll get a notification like on your phone. You'll get a notification in the message, like you got an email or something like that. So.
I don't get emails, and it's not connected to my phone, so.
Well, that's why you're not getting them.
Oh, okay.
The bell used to be emails, though.
Yeah, I'll be back in just a second, guys. I'm sorry.
Okay. That's how I used to basically watch YouTube. I'd never go and, like, check my subscription feed and everything. And now all of a sudden, it's like they're not there anymore. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like I get, I mean, it's crazy the emails I get. It cracks me up because, like, I'll get emails for videos that I'm not subscribed to, which I'm like, what the hell? You know what I mean? It's like, I don't even get that. And then, you know, it's weird who, you know, they'll send me to. They'll send me to the people I'm watching a lot of, but I just feel like the ones I'm already watching a lot of, I don't even need notifications from them, you know? And then, yeah, I don't know. It's just, it's all changed in the last, like, couple months, really. But just annoying.
I've never gotten an email about a notification from YouTube, but I have gotten, you know, like, whenever I click on subscriptions in my list, it seems to always come up there.
Yeah, it's always there, but, you know, like, that's the thing, is I like to subscribe to people that just, you know, follow me and stuff like that. So then, you know, I subscribe to a lot of people, and I mean, you know, just the stuff gets buried and then I don't go there. Just, I don't know. I'm just used to looking in my email and it'd all be in there, you know? So.
Yeah. I just click on, you know, like if I don't know who I'm going to directly, I'll just go through my subscriptions and
Yeah.
See what interests me.
Right. Yeah.
Because their suggestions are usually like, you know, well, I've seen that 12 times.
I know.
You know, it's the same stuff. And when you change it up, it's a new group of the same stuff.
Yeah. I noticed that too. Like, it seems like there's like a lot of repetitive comment or content in the sidebar.
Yeah.
Like, I don't remember what I was looking at last night, but I can't remember what was in there. But I mean, it was like, you know, a video I've seen that sucker in the sidebar for like, you know, like 5 years now. And it's like I watched it a long time ago, but you know.
Yeah, it's like,
I don't know. Why do they just constantly, they're just pushing it, like, just go watch this video. We know you want to watch this. We know it. I don't know.
Yeah, it's like, just because you watch something doesn't mean that's completely where your interests lie.
Yeah, that's true.
And it's funny how things get twisted. Like, no, I just watched that thing once, and
right. Yeah, I know. It's almost like, God forbid you click on some of this stuff, because it's like, then they're just absolutely convinced, you know. Like, if you're ever watching, like, I notice, you know, like, I'll go down these rabbit holes on YouTube watching, I don't know, like, you know, like the abandoned stuff sometimes. I'll start clicking those guys that go around and look in abandoned buildings and under highway abandoned bridges and stuff. And then there'll always be the one that gets in there that's like top 10 abandoned mines or top 10 abandoned ghost photos or something. And then if you click it, if you're just like dumb enough to click that one, nothing but the, you know, it's just like all top 10 blah blah blah, you know. That one's always like, you know, it's never like, you know, it's like the ones where they, you know, I don't know, they get a bunch of different clips you see on other videos and stuff. They're never like any of the real guys that are doing it, you know.
Yeah.
Hey guys, I'm back.
Hey.
Oh. Newsflash.
Okay. Was my mic on when I left or something? Or wow.
Yeah, I'm fine. This is like the time when we're trying to think, but we're trying to keep the conversation going.
I know. It's like, until you get that first idea down, it's so hard to like talk and figure it out. Was it luck? Was it luck last week that I actually got it done? Can I do it again?
You can do it. Oh. I believe in you.
Go check, see what's going on in the chat.
Yeah, is anybody in the chat drawing along with us or trying to do this challenge?
Dude, I can't believe you're modeling, dude. You're modeling the challenge.
Well, I can't draw, so I'm doing this for you guys.
Okay.
Yeah, I would. I wouldn't even be a guest, I think, if it depended on me drawing.
Guess so, that's drawing, but it's client work.
Yeah. You got a left hand, dude. What are you doing? Come on. Both hands at the same time. What the heck?
Who are you talking to?
Oh, Gazbot in the chat. He said he's drawing for his client work.
And okay. Craig says, watching while inking a piece. How do you watch and ink your own work?
He's just that good.
Just that good.
I love getting on an Artcast or something similar and working, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm always looking listening. For
that. Yeah.
Listening. I try not to watch.
Yeah. Okay. So what are you doing, Mike? Are you going to do like a full body shot or what?
No, I thought about it for a second. I was going to if it was the Death Dealer, because I was going to get the horse in there, but...
Oh, my Lord. You drive the horse? That's like the hardest part, brother.
You would have won, though, if you would have nailed it.
Yeah.
Well, I would have sculpted like a part of a horse, probably not the full.
Just the head. I swear I was working on it.
Well, Mike can sculpt. You're going to see, dude. We'll just see how much he gets done.
Jeff, please, man. I don't need any extra pressure, but I do appreciate it.
All eyes on Mike now.
I'm still a little rusty. I just got back from a contract job in South Dakota, and I didn't do any art for like 7 months while I was there.
That sucks.
So I'm still a little bit rusty.
I mean, good for me, but that sucks. For the competition. No. I mean, everybody should draw every day if possible. Or do something that they love.
Yeah, definitely.
I love to eat every day.
Well, dude, you're one step ahead of the game.
It's called survival.
If you do it and you love it, you're surviving like in style. Boom. Oh, yeah.
What kind of commissions are you working on, Brad?
So I got another family portrait to do that I've been waiting like 6 months. So I need to finish that. And then I have a silk I need to do. Marble silk. What else do I got to do? I got two small ones that are all drawn out. I just need to color them. I think that's about it right now. And then I'm going to be working on my book after that. So
that's cool.
What book is that?
The Handyman. The one I canceled.
You canceled it.
I canceled it today.
No, man. Don't cancel it.
Not permanently. Yeah, there's just no way. I wasn't going to get close to the funding I needed. So It was hard to do. Like I was like,
What reason do you think it was that it didn't fund? Was it just not a big enough audience, or
I think it was on the wrong platform? Yeah, I'm a nobody. So the people who usually follow me, like on Facebook, where my biggest following is, you know, they don't like super violent books, you know, and I'm super violent. Like they support you, but they don't support you, type thing, and that's fine, you know, kind of like mom and dad, you know. It's kind of like a mom and dad. It's great, you do your best, you know, and then we're going to stand over here, wait for you to fall and come back home, you know, type thing. So,
thanks.
Yeah.
Holy crap. That sounds like a lot of pressure.
Not a lot of pressure. No, it's fine. But, you know, there's just, you know, there were some who helped me out, you know, some who were on the list and stuff. It was fine. But it's a niche book. Nobody knows who I am. My campaign really wasn't set up as optimally as possible. But it's okay. You know, you live and learn. Not every campaign is going to fire the first time. So.
No, yeah. I was just wondering if you thought maybe it was because you were on Indiegogo or if it was on because.
No, I think Indiegogo is becoming the way for comics right now. Okay. Yeah. It's much more friendly, I believe, to comics. I don't know if you know the whole comic skate thing. I'm a comic skater, so. But it's where all of them hang out. So. Yeah.
Well, right on, man. Well, good luck on the next go round. Do you know when you might launch it?
Next, I'm shooting for either 1st of December or 1st of February. Because from what I understand, looking at sales records, Indiegogo sucks for January. Yeah. So.
You're going to do it like the beginning of December or something?
Either that or, yeah, see how far along I am. And then if that's not going to work, I'll wait for February 1st. So.
Well, sweet. Now that I actually know who you are, I'll try and keep tabs and help you out.
Don't worry. I'll be around. Like, I'm not going silent on social media or people I know or anything like that. I mean, Jeff might kick me off and push me to the curb, but I'll be around.
Oh, you're still here?
I'm sorry. Yeah, there we go.
Let me fix that real quick.
Yep. Uninvite. See you. No. Like, you know, it's like I like talking to people. I like, you know, doing artwork with people and stuff like that. And it's been a lot of fun, like getting to know everybody and reaching out. So yeah.
Yeah, now's the time to build that, you know what I mean? Continue building that audience.
Yeah, exactly. So like I'll be here every Thursday if possible. Worm my way in. Hey, what are you doing today? Need someone else? You know,
type well, stuff. Yeah, that's fine. So you were talking to, I think you said, you were saying you and John Malin were kind of talking about canceling it, and then that's how come you ended up doing it?
Yeah, so John was giving me a lot of feedback. Part of it was the way my campaign was set up. Part of it was pricing, you know, for items, you know.
Yeah.
And then most of it was just getting my name out there.
Yeah.
That's most of it. Yeah.
I noticed you changed that, the art on your front page. Like yesterday when I went to look and see how it was doing, you had changed that. And I got to admit, I liked it a lot better because, you know, you had that logo, which was cool, but it's like it didn't really hit you in the face. Like,
and that was the thing they brought up to me, you know, and stuff. And so,
and then,
you know, he said, you know, what we want you to do is, you know, or what we suggest you do is, I would stop your campaign, take a couple months, tool up, stay active in the community, which I plan on doing. And then, Critias, too, is on my side. He's the one who's doing Detective Dead picks. They're like, just stay active in the community. As soon as you're ready to launch, we'll put you on the main show over there. So with John and everybody else. So I'm like, all right, cool. So because they really dug my artwork and they liked how it was doing it and active in the community, supportive of everybody else and trying to help people out. So
yeah,
that's just who I am normally, but you know, it takes a while for people to get to know you. So you know,
yeah, most definitely.
Yeah, I think it's probably a good idea. I mean, that you know, brand comic. What's his name? Bryce. He was telling me. And, you know, the first couple were, you know, I think he said one was like $99 or something crazy like that.
It was $94, and he couldn't even keep the money because it didn't reach the $100 minimum. Yeah. And he was like, dude, it sucked. And then he happened to tweet out some artwork, and Ethan saw it, brought him on the show, and then he's now made 50-something thousand, I think.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's pretty crazy.
So, you know, I believe there's money to be made out there in indie comics, you know. I just don't, you know, working at a comic book shop, I see how little advertising the other companies do, you know, like Aspen or them, like they don't even get noticed in previews at all. Like, it's horrible. So, and it's just, I don't know. It's when we were talking about, you know, when you were talking about, you know, the market needs to change, I totally agree with you, you know. So,
yeah.
So are you thinking about, do you have like a Patreon or anything?
I don't, no.
Is that something you're kind of thinking about?
Not really, to be honest. Well, brand's at 46.9185 right now. I prefer, like, if you want to support me, you know, hire me to do a commission for you or something like that. Like, you don't have to pay me $3 a month to watch me draw, you know. Like, maybe once a year, buy something from me or whatever. Like, I don't know. I mean, I'm not knocking it, but I just don't know if it's for me or not. So,
yeah. Well, we've been talking a lot about Patreon. I think, especially since Brubaker, I don't know if you've seen what he's doing, where he's giving away a book on his
Patreon. Art Brubaker?
A what?
Jason. Oh, Jason? Oh, okay.
Yeah, Jason Brubaker. But he's giving away a 120-page black and white book if you sign up to his $5 level. I think this is actually over now, but for like last month. And he went, like, he made a video a little while ago talking about how he went pretty much from $400 up to like $1,500 doing this. But by the same token, I mean, it's a, you know, it's a 120-page black and white comic or book, basically graphic novel, that he's sending out to people. So it's a kind of a risky move, but then I don't know, you know, he definitely got some growth out of that for sure.
Well, is everybody doing it, or is it just one person getting it?
What do you mean?
Everybody who pledged five.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
Do they have a minimum pledge for the number of months, like they had to do it? Because I know that's a thing sometimes too.
So. It's at least $5, I think.
Yeah, yeah. No. What I mean is, like, do they have to sign up for 6 months? Do they have to?
No, just 1 month.
Just 1 month. That is pretty risky.
He was talking about it on a couple of his shows, and then the show he did with Tenaple, and he was talking about how, I mean, I guess, like, I mean, I'm kind of speaking for him, but I think what he's thinking is, like, you know, by getting people on for 1 month, a lot of those people are going to stay past that 1 month.
Gotcha.
And continue to support, which could totally be true. I don't know. You know, I guess we're all just going to have to wait and find out. But I think it's interesting. You know, it's like it's kind of the first sort of movement I've seen anybody do on Patreon beyond just, because you kind of got two groups. You got people that just go on there. They have such a huge audience that they, you know, instantly, you know, make a couple thousand a month and everything's cool. And then, you know, you got the people that do porn. They set it up like a porn site, you know.
A lot of those female streamers should do it. It's,
well, you know, no, so. I didn't mean that. Yeah, you're talking
about,
well,
no, it's porn. True. Yeah.
That could be on there, but I'm talking about like people that do like the fan art porn, you know what I mean?
Oh,
like the anime, you know. So it's like stuff like that, and it's kind of like, you know, if you want to see the real stuff, you know, sign up for $5 and all that. And like a lot of those people are really successful on Patreon at those. But, you know, that
people are that they have to look at anime porn all the time.
Yeah.
Sorry. But, yeah.
Come on, you're offending my anime crowd now.
Oh, just all sorts of offenses today. Oh my gosh. Right.
Stop it. But, you know, it's that's why I find it interesting, because like I don't, you know, I'm not going that way with the anime porn or whatever, fan art porn.
And then, I mean, yeah, you do the real stuff.
Right. But you know what I mean, though? It's just, yeah, you know, here's like a guy kind of like just doing comics and sort of, you know, figuring out a way to get some people on, you know, whether it ends up being successful or not. But I'm definitely interested in watching for sure. Let's see what's going on in the chat here.
Hey, Ox showed up. I saw that.
Hey, Ox. Oh, cool. Hey, Pixel Trader, he's in there too.
Yeah, it looks like he's got one on Patreon. He has one Patreon. Yeah. I mean, I guess it just starts with one, you keep going, so. Yeah, I just never really thought about it, so.
Yeah. Well, I think the other side of it, which, you know, this came into my mind, with, you know, right when I saw it, was I was kind of like, 120-page book, you know, you could go on to, like, you know, Indiegogo or Kickstarter, especially him, where he's already done it, and probably, you know, make 30,000, you know, like he does on all of his books, you know?
Yeah.
And this just seems like a lot more work, but then, I don't know, you know, like, if you could really, you know, I mean, like, he's at 1,500 now, if you could get up to, like, $5,000 a month or something like that, and, you know, was doing a book every few months, I mean, I don't know, it might be worth it, so... I mean, the only other side I don't like about it much is the idea of shrinking the audience, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because people feel left out who aren't a part of it.
Yeah, and you're locking away your work. You're not really showing it to a ton of people, and that I don't dig so much.
Yeah.
Well, he might be, you know, looking long term, where he's just trying to capture that Patreon audience and just not worry about these big Kickstarter campaigns that take up all his time.
Yeah, that could be, but I don't know, though. If you're sending a book, and you're kind of doing all the work of the Kickstarter right there, almost. But I guess you're doing it to a lot less of a degree, a lot less people.
Yeah, it's...
So you don't have to sell as hard, either.
What was that?
It's less urgent, you know. Right. Than a Kickstarter, and you know, yeah, you don't have to push as hard.
Yeah, it's kind of like an ongoing kind of thing. Let's see. Is that it? No other thoughts?
Oh, sorry, I'm thinking about the lines.
I like the idea of what he's doing. I think it's it's working. So he had over 100% growth in that month alone.
So yeah,
if that's his goal, he's definitely, you know, if his goal is to grow Patreon, then it's definitely working.
Ox said, I don't think he's allowed to publish Cythra until it's done, since he was paid for by Webtoons for its exclusivity.
Right.
Gazbot's going to sleep. Let's see.
Right.
Yeah, I don't. I kind of doubt that's true, though. But yeah, it could be. But I don't know. I almost wonder if, like, their deal might be kind of a licensing deal rather than, you know, this is, you know, like if you're doing it for Marvel, you can't publish until it's outside of there or something, you know, or not Marvel, but, you know, say Image or something. But maybe, I mean, a webcomic site is not really that, you know, powerful, I guess, you know what I mean? It doesn't hold that much clout, you know? I don't know. Like exclusive publishing deals and stuff like that. Pretty much usually with stuff like that, it's pretty open, you know? So but I might be completely wrong.
I have a customer at the shop who's a webcomic guy, and his name is Howard Taylor, and he runs Schlock Mercenary.
Oh, yeah. He's actually pretty well-known.
Yes, he is. So he was like, you should do webcomics. I'm like, I don't know, you know. And then when his Indiegogo went off for his Kickstarter, I was like, dang, man, for his game, based off his universe, that was crazy. So like, he did like 300,000 for his role-playing game.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was insane. Pretty impressive, man. Yeah. But he's a cool dude. He's a fun guy.
That's cool.
And if he wasn't, you would tell us?
Yeah. Well, I just maybe you know hold my judgment a little more silently. You know.
Yeah, it's that's pretty awesome. I don't really pay much attention to his comic, but I've seen him on a lot of the webcomics shows and stuff. And
yeah, he gets around. He does a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. Most time I hear from him, he's traveling somewhere. So
yeah. Webcomics was definitely, and I mean, I guess it's still the thing, but it just seemed like it was all the, everybody was doing webcomics there for a little bit. And long form type comics were the ones that were not going anywhere. Now it's kind of shifting around again, which is cool.
Well, I think it's that, you know, resurgence or, you know, renaissance in the comics right now.
Oh, you mean
more creative driven books? Yeah.
Or what were you saying there?
Sorry, I was thinking there was, I think the shift is happening because creators are starting to realize they're not going to make it in the big industries, and there's no money there, so they're switching, and it's bringing more people over to it. So
I think it's Warren Ellis and Colleen Duran doing a webcomic on Webtoons.
Oh, really?
So, like, yeah, so, like, big names in the industry. And that wasn't the first one I saw. It's like there definitely seems to be more known names going over there and, I guess, trying to take the spotlight to the right. away from all the hundreds of other creators out there.
Yeah. I've kind of wondered, you know, for a long time, like when people were going to come from the mainstream, the sort of the web, and just start putting their books out. I mean, I've thought, you know, forever, like, you know, just think of like Adam Hughes came over, started running Kickstarters, or like Travis Charest or something.
He'd make millions, probably.
He really would, you know. And I don't know. When does it ideas pop in their head? I don't know. Or maybe they're just happy where they're at, doing what they do. So.
Or maybe they're under some sort of contract that they can't get out of or something.
That could be true.
Exclusive contract with Marvel. Does that, you know, go into your own work, though? I just think that's like kind of usually.
From
like,
what Ethan was saying, he was able to do his own work when he was at DC for his exclusivity contract. So.
What was he doing?
His Cyberfrog stuff, like, but.
Were there issues coming out while he was at DC?
No, he was just working out, though, going to run a Kickstarter, and he asked about it. He was talking about it in one of his shows. And this, yeah, it's not a problem. So.
Yeah, I mean, you know, most people working for DC aren't under contract, but I guess if you're under contract, you should probably ask.
I would. Don't want to hurt my exclusivity deal. That's for sure.
No. I mean, I had a contract at DC, but, you know, it's just like, another team came in, no more contracts.
Totally. It's almost like why do they even have a sign them? It's just like,
yeah, it's like, you know. I was excited last week, but now not so much.
I'm unemployed again.
Yeah, that sucks, dude. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Just a business, though.
Yeah. I know, but I think I just don't like how they treat, you know, freelance artists and stuff like that and creators and just like disposable. You're like, oh, hey, look, the new hotness is here, you know.
Yeah.
So thanks for all your experience and, you know, see ya. It's like, oh, okay. Yeah. But
yeah, you
know, I'm an outsider though looking in, so.
Well, no, I think it is a lot like that. for as much as people have said that, you know, things have changed, you know, since like Kirby and all that kind of stuff, I don't think it really has actually that much. You know, you get your original art back now.
Yeah.
But it's like, you know what I mean, though? You're still working on their characters under their contracts. And, you know, a lot of times whatever you make for them, you know, like characters and stuff, it's just totally owned by them. You know, you talk comics is one thing, but like, you know, you get into like movies, work for Disney and stuff like that. You're not, you know, you ain't even get the deal you're getting in comics over there, you know? So.
I mean, you know, it's like, you know, that going in and, you know.
Yeah.
You know, that's why you want to work for them. And in many cases, like, yeah, I want to work on a Spider-Man book. I want to work on a Batman book, whatever.
Yeah.
Totally. I used to feel that way. I don't anymore.
Really?
Yeah. Like, I used to want to draw an X-Men book and so we had or whatever. And I was like, I don't know. You know, several years ago, I was like, no, I really don't want to, you know.
Changed.
What was that?
What changed?
Probably when I started drawing my own stuff, I was like, you know, I don't want them to own it, you know. I want to own my own character, you know. So.
Well, yeah, it's.
If someone was to like say, "Hey, Brad, we want you to come work on Spider-Man," you wouldn't want to do that?
I don't know. I'd have to think about it, but you know, like if like you know, hey, we want you to make a new character for Spider-Man, that'd be a little bit different. You know, like I don't want to go away. Like I want to be mine still.
Well, I'm just saying
I just don't feel like I want to work for Marvel anymore. You know, I don't want to work for someone else, I should say. You know.
I was going to hire you, but.
Oh, okay. Contract, Pete. Hold on.
Just make up a bunch of characters and I'll own them.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. It's like, if it was in front of me, I'd have to think about it. I'd really have to think about it, but I don't know. I remember one time, like, when I was trying out for books and stuff, like, I sent off artwork and got rejection letters and stuff, but I remember one guy told me, he's like, yeah, your artwork's never going to be good enough to be Marvel way. I'm like, wait, what? He's like, you know, you should just do indie books and just stick with those. And I'm like, oh, okay. But
you know what I mean?
Yeah, he really pissed me off. But
yeah, who was it, artist or was it editor?
It was an artist, colorist actually.
Fucking colorist is telling you like how good your art is. Yeah, I'd tell him where to put his shit.
I would.
It's like I'm gonna fucking draw, dude.
He had a stroke, and I feel bad for him now because he's like recovering, you know. But yeah, so I don't want to hate the guy, you know. Sure. But I remember him telling me that completely, and he doesn't remember the conversation at all anymore. So I'm like, all right, that's fine. I'm just gonna be his friend. But yeah, I remember when he told me. I was like, oh my gosh, dude, that's like brutal.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you know,
so it's like,
all right,
whatever.
Well, yeah, I've been there too. I don't know if anybody ever said, you know, just bluntly, you know, get out of comics.
Your art's never going to be good enough.
I've definitely had, plenty of negative portfolio reviews, you know. I don't know. That's just part of the game.
Oh, yeah, it totally is. Someone's got an airbrush going or a compressor.
Yeah, I think that's Mike.
Yeah, that's me. Sorry.
Yeah, no problem. Pixel says, Travis Travis work lately doesn't look nearly as nice as his 90s work during Wildcats and those old Wolverine books. Don't know what happened. 20 years or so happened?
Maybe his hands don't work as well, you know?
Or he's not trying as hard. I mean, that stuff took him forever. That stuff happened.
Was freaking amazing back then. That's like a high bar to stick to for sure.
Plus, he was probably paid, you know, like $1,000 a page,
yeah.
And given all the time in the world to work on it, and you know, also get a bonus car. You know, because it was just crazy times back then. And everybody got 90s, crazy. Yeah.
They're making millions of, selling millions and millions of copies.
Yeah. Yep.
I was watching a video right before you and I started talking, Pete, today. It was about, right. What's his name? Greg Land, the artist.
Right.
Yeah. And how he photocopies everything right now. I was like, and then they showed his work, and like, yeah, he's pretty much like, he draws over top. He's tracing other people's work. He traces his own work, and then he traces porn models and stuff. I was like, oh, you know, because like they were pointing out, like when he was doing, was it
Christian?
Fantastic Four Unlimited, right? For Marvel, they were showing the same book. There was no consistency between the hair and the facial expressions for the pages. And they all looked like they were having orgasms. And you're like, oh my gosh. Like, yeah, that's kind of sad.
Greg Land, was it that you said?
Yeah, Gregory Land or something like that, yeah.
Yeah. I really like his work.
A lot of people do.
I don't know what he's doing now. I mean, I haven't really followed anyone lately, but
he used to work at CrossGen.
Yeah, I know his work from CrossGen originally. I know he moved to Marvel. But really, I mean, you know, his work as CrossGen was gorgeous. You know, yes.
Yeah, so it's after he left CrossGen though that he started doing all the tracing.
Yeah.
CrossGen, wasn't everybody like freaking face to face, table to table or something?
They were.
Did everybody have to go to work.
We're talking about that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Isn't where my brother Wade lives. Too? Yeah, Mark Wade worked there.
Where my brother lives, a lot of the people that work at CrossGen are living over there. Because that's where, yeah, they lived out. They worked out of Florida.
Florida, right? Yeah. Yeah, I remember when that thing was forming and a lot of people talking about heading down there to give it a shot and everything, and then.
It went Abe saw the video.
What'd you say?
Oh, Abe Sapien saw the video, he said, so.
Yeah.
That I was talking about.
Yeah.
But
Abe Sapien, that name sounds familiar. What's up, man?
Hellboy.
Oh, did you guys see the new Hellboy artwork that dropped this last week?
No.
I saw the poster. I'm not sure what to make of it. It looks like it was photo retouched 100 times.
Oh, totally. But still looks cool.
Yeah. No, it's like, it's no indication of what the movie's going to look like. But
no, but it's like Conan meets Hellboy. It looks so cool.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, because he has a big flaming sword.
Cool.
Did it? Yeah.
Yeah, the original Hellboy will look like a cartoon in comparison, I'm sure.
Most likely.
That's wild.
You know, which I love the, you know, the first two Hellboy movies, so, but I am excited to see this one.
Is it by Guillermo del Toro and everything? Same guy or different? Or
it's different. I forget who's the director, but it's different people altogether.
Yeah, they're not letting him finish his trilogy.
Yeah.
That's kind of sad. So there were supposed to be three of those then?
Yep.
Well, you know, Guillermo's got like 20 movies lined up or something. You know, he'll do three.
Right.
You know, he's always like, oh, this is a great idea. I'm going to do this next. No, this is a...
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's cool. I like Hellboy. I like those movies a lot. I hope it's...
Yeah.
You know, stays up to snuff or whatever. So, sure, probably.
Yeah, the actor for who's playing Hellboy is the guy from the sheriff from Stranger Things.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Wow. Yes. So he even switched
up. He buffed up, yeah.
That's interesting. That guy's kind of cool.
Yeah, they put him on the Marvel workout diet, it looks like.
I mean, Well, I mean, yeah, like the first Hellboy, you know, he was just a full like silicone or latex suit. I mean, this guy's like, there's real skin under this dude. Because, I mean, I would think he'd got to be way smaller than the first Hellboy if they're not going to special effects him up, you know?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure what they're doing. You know, I've just seen the poster and a couple of shots. You can't tell what's what.
Yeah.
He does have a belly, though. You know, while he's buff, he does have like a beer belly.
That's wild.
So it's cool.
Is that how he is in the comics? Kind of buff with the beer belly?
No, I don't think so.
Mike Mignola draws him a little strange, you know, so.
Yeah. I mean, he's you know, muscular for sure. I don't really remember him having a bunch of a belly, but he's got a weird style anyway.
So, can't tell what's going on with Mike.
Everything's in the shadows.
Yeah, man. I love it. I love his style.
Oh, yeah, it's great. Yeah. I like it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I liked him when he was doing Batman. That was so cool.
Yeah.
You ever read Cosmic Odyssey?
Is that early help, or I mean early Magnolia stuff right there?
That's it's earlier. Yeah, it's before Hellboy. It's
back when he drawed like normal.
A story. Well, it was his style, but early version of it.
Yeah.
And it was a Jim Stalin story, you know, written by Jim Stalin. And it's the story where John Stewart, the Black Green Lantern, accidentally destroys a planet.
Hmm.
Sorry. Oops.
Oops. Oops. And, yeah, it's just, you know, it was cool seeing him draw DC characters and.
Yeah. It's pretty cool. I mean, I don't know which one it was, but I remember he did that Wolverine miniseries. That was really neat. It kind of goes back to like the Savage Land or something. He's got like dinosaurs and Wolverine in it. That was kind of when he was kind of starting to get his style, I think. That was the one he would later have anyway.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I think originally he wanted to be an anchor.
Yeah.
It shows with all the blacks.
Yes, that's what it is. That's where it came from.
Yeah.
He worships the well of ink.
I thought he was. Is he doing comics anymore? I thought he was like off doing like watercolors and.
He's just writing.
He's writing now.
He was painting for a little while. I think he's posting old pieces for, you know, in celebration of Inktober.
Oh yeah, that's cool.
But yeah, I don't, you know.
Yeah, the only time I see him is in previews and stuff like that when he's they're showing off the new books that he's written. So he has a bunch of new books out, but.
Like novels? What are you talking about?
Like, I think there's a couple graphic novels, but they're a series that Mike's writing.
So it's Hellboy related or something else entirely?
No, some are some other ones. I can't remember these off the top of my head. I don't have the previews in front of me, but there's a new one out that's coming out. So, but Dark Horse is doing them, so.
Man, I used to pick up previews all the time and go through it cover to cover and know everybody who's working on everything. I swear I was an encyclopedia for everybody. Yeah. And now I have no clue who's doing what.
Well, I kind of have to a little bit. So.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I've lost a lot of touch, but I don't know. I've been going back in to the comic shop buying comics again, and I find myself getting back into it.
What did you buy lately?
Well, right now I'm really digging that Headlopper. That's what I've been reading. So, what was the last one I picked up?
It's a good looking book. I like the artist.
Yeah, it's like a weird style. It kind of reminds me of like that Adventure Time style.
Mm-hmm.
But I still like it though, even though it's kind of real simple and everything. So
that's good design sense.
Yeah, definitely. And really, really great storytelling. The writing's pretty fun. The story is kind of interesting enough. It actually keeps me going, you know, which is cool.
You can actually just tag Jeff in it on Twitter for the drawing that you're doing.
Yeah, send it. If you can go on Twitter, send it to me like a direct message if you can. Since I'm not that Twitter adept or whatever. I guess if you tag me, then it'll come in my notifications, right?
Yeah.
Okay. That was quick, man. How much time we got?
I don't know. What's the clock?
We're at an hour and 20 minutes.
Oh.
That's how much time we've spent, or that's how much time we have left?
That's how much time we got left.
I'm doing a small one today, so it's like, I feel like I'm going too fast. Like the last time I was doing 11 by 17, I was like,
yeah.
Yeah.
That's pretty rugged.
Yeah, I was thinking about doing a smaller piece, but well, this is the same size as the other one, which is 8.5 by 11. So.
Yeah, I'm doing 9 by 12, so
I guess I'm doing 8.5 by 11.
What's the Twitter channel? Twitter for Jeff is what's your idea of Twitter? Do you remember, Jeff?
Jeff,
I can look it up.
I think it's Jeff Lafferty.
Yeah.
It's just Jeff Lafferty. Okay.
Yeah, it's at Jeff_Lafferty.
You can tag me too if you want. It's just Pencil for Life. So.
Peter Palmiotti.
So what kind of contract work were you doing in North Dakota for 7 months?
It's for non-destructive testing.
What is that?
Basically just like looking inside of welds and looking for defects or lack of fusion or something along welds for wind towers.
Oh, okay.
It wasn't art related.
No, that's cool though. Like I watch a lot of engineering shows and stuff like that because it gives me ideas for buildings and how stuff works and things like that. Because I don't know, I just find it interesting. Like I watch a lot of car shows, car repairs, car restoration. Mega structure shows.
Right on.
Yeah. My grandpa got me into a love of engineering. He used to build his own trailers and sheds and repair cars. And so.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah, he was a cool dude.
Have you ever fixed up a car?
Yeah. I took AP Auto and stuff like that when I was younger, and I still know how to do all my basic mechanic stuff, you know.
I know.
So I can change my own oil and spark plugs, alternators, you know, normal stuff.
Yeah. Working on cars is fun, like when all the tools, you know, like how they have cooking shows where everything's already out and pre-measured tools and everything.
Yep.
That's pretty much the only scenario when working on cars is like a blast.
True. Very true.
If you gotta look for one tool, then it's like, ugh,
yeah,
screws.
Then you start going, how can I fix this without that tool?
You don't like working on them like in a blizzard in the driveway, Mike? Is that what you're saying?
That's another thing that's fun about it.
I did that with an alternator. That sucked.
Yeah, I've definitely done those too.
Oh.
Well, me and Mike, we were working together a little while ago. This was when I did some painting, like about, I don't know how long ago was that, Mike? I guess it's been a while because you went to South Dakota and came back. So.
At least 7 months.
Yeah, we were doing some painting down in Denver, and Mike came down in his car, and thing was breaking down like every 2 days or whatever.
Well, what was happening was I was like letting my sister use my car.
Yeah.
Which is not a really nice car, but a functioning car. and then my folks have this like really old Toyota Tercel wagon. It's like the same one that the Jesse from Breaking Bad. It's like that same kind of wagon.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And so that's what I was using, and like it's a 1983 or something, and it like broke down on the highway one time because the weather wasn't the greatest. So I let my sister use my, because she was driving a Pueblo to do her job. And I figure if she broke down in it, then, you know, she probably would have a tougher time getting it fixed.
Yeah.
You don't have Twitter, just Messenger? I think you can probably just message or tag Jeff Lafferty on Facebook.
Yeah, if you're on Facebook, friend me, and then... But you got to friend me or I won't see the message. It'll go into some weird folder. Be lost forever. Or there's somebody on Facebook that wants to come on, actually. Dustin Martin.
Dustin Martin?
Yeah, do you know him?
No. Sounds familiar, though. I don't know where, though.
Invite him into the chat. Justin Martin? He's in the chat. He's in the video chat.
All right. I'll send you a link.
Yeah, bring him in. More the merrier.
Give it a shot.
I don't know. That's brave. I don't.
Well, it sounded like you were vouching for him. You were like, "Oh, it's Justin Martin."
I'm saying there's a Justin Martin in the chat. That's all I'm vouching for.
All right. Hold on to your butts, right?
What's the worst getting that could happen?
Right. I mean, after the Artcasters and some.
Just make sure you're wearing clothes, Justin. That's all we ask.
We've probably been, through it all. I remember having.
Too late, you got the link.
I always remember the chat when, and you were on the show, Mike, because you were the one who were laughing about it later. But, not to bust on Kieran, because he became like our friend and everything. But that guy, Kieran, he was like an English guy. Remember that, Pete? I don't know if you were on that show when he came on the first time.
I don't think so.
He's like that soccer player, and then he draws also. And man, his like accent was like so bad. And then plus his like webcam was just not so great. And it was like, oh. It was so hard to like understand what he was saying and stuff. I was getting out every third word, and I don't think Mike was getting anything.
Yeah, I was having a really tough time that day.
That was rugged.
Hey, by the way, has my mic been behaving tonight?
Yeah, it sounds pretty good.
Okay, all right.
It has.
So much for having 7.1 surround sound headphones.
Yeah.
I'm going to miss those things.
Maybe I sent them wrong. Oh, no, that's it. Okay.
You sent them around the world.
They sent him, like, the link back to the same video. There you go.
We know you're not working.
There we are.
Holy. Yeah, but I remember that when Mike's car was breaking down. Oh, man, he got broke down, like, right on the highway. Calls me up. He's like, Jeff, I'm on the highway.
That was bad. Like this Denver cop, he pulled over, and he's like, he got out. He's like, what the hell's the problem? It's like semis whizzing by.
Yeah, I mean, this is like, 9 o'clock, the center of fucking Denver. Tuesday morning or something. I mean, just like you could not find worse traffic in like all of like the West of, you know. I mean, yeah. When you broke down, I was like, well, how that, you know, how am I even gonna get in there and help you? It's like impossible.
Yeah, I was just getting ready to.
Yeah.
Is this how I go? Type of deal.
Just leave the car.
Yeah, the cop pushed him out of the way.
Yeah, there was no leaving the car. I couldn't. I literally, there was huge semis just whizzing by at 90 miles an hour. Yeah. People were honking like it was my fault.
That was bad. And then remember, like we get it over to the place because you like he pushes you out of the way, and then doesn't it? He calls a tow truck for you or something, or you call a tow truck.
Yeah.
And then the thing starts up, right?
Yeah. The alternator.
Right. Yeah. And then we're looking at it in the garage when he gets back there, and then like I reach down and I can't remember what I went to grab. But this thing just like wiggles, like it's just totally just hanging there by like one thread. It was the alternator, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a hell of an experience, that's for sure.
Yeah. So we tightened that up, but then there was something else still broke, wasn't there? It like worked for like a day, and then
it was just the alternator was just bad.
Oh, okay.
I'm sure it being loose like that didn't help anything. But
yeah, that probably just shaking the piss out of it. Wasn't helping it.
Plus it's probably like 35 years old or whatever. So
yeah,
definitely, you know, gave a pretty good life.
Yeah. Yeah, that was pretty crazy. Whatever, couple months there.
It was fun. It was fun working on that job.
It was actually kind of fun again.
There was some, you know, we got to talk pretty much art a lot of the day.
Yeah.
But, yeah, there were some funny customers in that place too.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was kind of fun just painting again. I hadn't painted in years.
We could have started a painting business, like right there. Everybody was like, you know, nobody wanted us to leave. And we're like, no, we have to leave. But yeah, I don't know. Painting's fun sometimes.
Yeah, it depends on so many things, really. Probably just like a lot of things.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like fixing a car, you're going to have the right tools.
That's right.
I painted a lot in my time, and I love it, you know, as long as I'm not doing it every day.
Yeah.
Love's a pretty strong word, Pete.
Well, my father owned a paint store, so I was painting my bedroom when I was 5.
Oh, that's cool.
Dang. Holy smokes.
Yeah, I was like, can I do it?
That's awesome. Sure.
Did somebody just come in, Justin?
Hey, guys.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey, welcome.
Thanks.
You wearing clothes?
Shit. Yeah. Do you have like a volume on your mic, or you're kind of like low?
Yeah, I'm trying to figure that one out right now. Sorry. Okay.
Maybe I can actually do it. I just popped open all the windows, so let me see if that helps at all.
How's that?
There we go. I think I just turned you up a little bit, so.
Okay, is that better?
Yeah.
Yep.
A little better.
Okay, because the mic might be far away, too. This is my podcast setup, so.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I actually sound real good now, so.
Yeah. And yes, I am wearing clothes. Thank you very much.
What kind of podcast do you do?
Well, I was putting one together. I still haven't gotten around to do it yet. I've done some interviews. Honestly, it was just a sit and talk about art with people.
Yeah.
Kind of a podcast. I've got a blog, a couple of blogs. I do poses mostly. I do pose reference.
Oh, are you a pose reference?
I've got a blog over on Tumblr with like 50,000 people on it. And
dude, that's cool.
And if I put out the all call over there, I've got at least 5 or 6 brave souls who will come on and talk with me every now and then. It's pretty cool. It's fun.
Hmm.
I still haven't, like,
nice.
You know, hit the bullet or pulled the trigger and gotten that done yet, though. So.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, I do. I do a series of like poses mostly. I always wanted to be a comic book artist, but I don't think I've got the chops to actually do it. It's the storytelling part of it that I have a hard time with.
Yeah. Did you try to be one, or you just kind of?
Yeah, actually, my mentor. It's funny you guys picked Usagi Yojimbo, because my art mentor is Sergio Aragones.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Mad Magazine.
Yeah. Yeah, awesome.
Grew.
And when I was a kid, I hung out in his studio and, you know, fetched him coffee for a couple of years. And
that's cool.
Be on my art, and, you know, it wound up being an art career. I'm actually a tattoo artist by trade.
Oh, dude, that's awesome.
You know, so. Sergio's not embarrassed that I turned out to be a tattoo artist. He's actually pretty proud of that.
Yeah.
That's yeah. Awesome.
I'm sorry. He's the guy who designed this bunny character.
No, that's Stan Sakai. Sorry. The segue was poor there. Stan Sakai and Sergio are sort of considered like legendary kind of old timey artists. You know.
Okay.
And him and Stan. Yeah. I think Stan inks Gru the Wanderer, the comic that Sergio does.
Okay.
Oh, does he ink it? I didn't realize that. Sergio did that himself, but maybe not.
Maybe he does the lettering. Oh, you know what? That's what it is. He does the lettering.
Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah, I know. It's odd that somebody like Stan would do that job, but he's been doing it for a million years, you know?
Yeah. That's neat. Yeah.
That's awesome.
How'd you fall into that? Like apprenticeship or whatever.
I used to take my sketchbook everywhere, and I bumped into somebody, and they're like, "Oh, you got to meet this guy. You know, he's a local in town, and you know, he draws comics." And I was like, "Okay, cool. I'd love to meet him." And it turned out to be this effing legend of an artist, you know. And Sergio was one of those guys who was just like, "Yeah, yeah, you want to be a comic book artist?" This is, by the way, this is 1990. You know.
Yeah.
This is a million years ago. And, you know, and Sergio was one of those guys who was, you know, I mean, he was cool with the kids. And so, you know, he'd let us in there, me and this guy named Steve Harrison. And Steve and I, you know, and he'd tell us how good our art was. And then, I don't know, there was one day when he realized that I wasn't leaving ever. You know, he decided to be mean about it. And, you know, and he really started to just rip our art apart and, you know, teach us how to be men, honestly. And it was just a good all around experience. Yeah. You know, I fetched a lot of coffee and stuff like that, but you know, he's one of those guys who has one of those studios with piles of artwork and Eisner awards and all that stuff. And so, you know, like if you went through the piles of art around this table, you know, you'd find Gil Kane and Boris Vallejo and I mean, like, you know, just real serious artwork. It was
That was like me and Sal Valuto when I was up there in his little room. Like piles of artwork everywhere you looked was like, oh dude, this is so cool.
Yeah,
why hasn't this seen the light of day for years? You know.
Yeah.
So 1990 was years ago, a million years ago.
I don't know how old you guys are, but I'm 46 now, so it feels, you know.
Yeah.
Well, am I the young guy in the room?
Well, my main blog is over on Tumblr, so the average age of my viewer is like 14, probably.
Yeah.
They're all drawing like melodrama anime shit. And...
Yeah.
Pardon my language.
You're good, dude.
Yeah, I'm close to your age. I'm a little older than you. Pete's like pretty close to me, right? Yeah.
I'm 55.
Okay.
Whoa, I'm the baby in the room. What the hell? This is the first.
I think Mike might be.
Mike, how old are you?
31.
Oh, you are. Damn it. was so hard. Yeah, because you know, I work at the comic shop. And it's like I'm 41, you know, and
you guys are fossils.
Every other freaking person walks in the door, besides the comics fans, like, oh, I'm 20, you know, or I'm 19.
Yeah.
You know, and then they start complaining how hard it is. I'm like, I don't want to hear that crap. Hard. You don't know hard yet. God.
It's not hard until you do an Indiegogo and it doesn't succeed.
Oh.
But it's okay. It will succeed.
Yeah, actually,
the second time around.
Because Mike did an Indiegogo that hasn't succeeded. I did a Kickstarter that failed. Pete, you ever done one that's failed?
I was a part of one that failed. I mean, that's the first experience on Kickstarter.
Yeah, I think everybody fails the first time.
What about Justin? Have you done one that failed yet?
Yes. Absolutely. Yeah, I did. It was I sort of invented a kind of sketchbook that had sketchbook paper and vellum every other sheet, so you could sketch and then flip the vellum back and then ink. And
save. Oh, I think I saw that.
And then it failed spectacularly. I think my mother pledged $50 or something. And then so I gave up on that. The funny bit is I just went into Hobby Lobby the other day, and it's on the shelf at Hobby Lobby. So
they've got it.
But then I had so I failed. Yeah, I've also I've done good too though, but
I failed. Oh, you did one that's funded. What was that one?
My art books. I've got a so that blog. I did 500 or 600 poses one year, and then the people on the blog were like, "You should do a book." So I was like, "Cool, I'll do a book." And I did a book, and yeah, it was like 700% funded that year. Ooh. It was pretty awesome. That's my one big win.
That's awesome, dude. Good job.
Nice.
Well, at the Denver Comic Con, Jeff, I sort of contacted you before the con to find out if you're going.
Yeah.
This year, you know, I kind of contacted you through Messenger. I don't know if you remember or not, but
I guess I just didn't remember. Sorry.
I'm in Colorado too, so it's just an easy con for me to go.
Awesome.
And what's funny is I was listening to you guys earlier. I live in Colorado, but I work in North Dakota.
Wow. Too much country.
Hey man, oil money. So I usually pimp my drawing books at the conventions, and it's turned out pretty good. So
that's cool.
It's paid for itself.
I keep trying to get in that one convention, but they don't let me in.
Denver?
Yeah, I keep getting turned down.
Dude, you know, well, you just sorry, I'm stuttering here. You got to know somebody now that it's gotten. It's the biggest artist alley in the country. You know, they have more artists in Denver than at any other convention, apparently. So the guys who are there tend to stick around. But if you really want in, you know, just contact me later, and
okay.
I know people. You know, I know.
Cool.
I'm not bragging. I know an artist who knows people.
The last 3 years to get in there, and I keep getting denied. Yeah,
dude, that sucks.
Yeah. Well, no, that happens.
Being on a short list, you know.
That's cool. So were you, when did you start showing at Denver? Were you ever there when I was there? Because I showed for a couple of years and then I stopped.
I've done all the, I did the first year, the big Denver Con, the one that they have now. I think they've just renamed it because Salt Lake City got sued by Comic-Con. So Denver proactively renamed theirs. But anyway, I was there the first year I just went in as a guest. Not as a guest. I bought a ticket and went in as a, you know, shopper, I don't know what you call them, an attendee. And then the last couple of years, and then since then I've had a table. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Cause I was there the first year, I was there the second and the third, but I haven't been back. So.
Yeah. Do you know Monty Moore?
Yeah. I know.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I didn't mean it in a bad way.
Yeah, that sounded
good. I didn't know him from like way back in the day. So.
Well, Monty's dug into that show. He was one of the early guys to back it. You know, he had Majesticon for a while there in Colorado. He was trying to get that going. Right. And it never really took.
I do remember that.
Monty is definitely like involved with the guys who founded Denver.
Oh, is he? And,
yeah. And we've been, I've been, Monty and I have been at shows together since the 90s. You know, so.
Well, did you, I mean, did we ever meet? Because I used to go to the Denver cons when they were at the hotel cons back when Monty was running the cons. A long time ago.
We must have met at some point, honestly. We must have. The first time, you know, Jeff, I started following you here on the Artcasters on YouTube.
Yeah.
Like, that's my first memory. It's like, you know, I was watching you do your 100 days challenge, you know.
Oh, okay. So super, recently. Yeah.
Super impressive. Oh, yeah. Just in like the last 6 months or 8 months or something like that.
Yeah.
So when you put an all call out that you and a bunch of guys are drawing for the night, and, you know, of course, I'm going to jump into that.
No, that's really cool. I'm glad you came in. You seem like a nice guy. That's pretty weird, though, that we've been kind of running in the same circles and, you know what I mean? haven't met up, you know? Especially if you're going back to, like, because, I mean, those cons weren't very big back in the day, you know, when they were in the hotels and stuff.
Oh, yeah, dude. I went to a bunch of them. I was, I went to the Majesticon when Brereton was there, Dan Brereton. That was 98 or 99. I actually did a self-published comic back in the day. It was so bad. But that was like the first year that I like hung out with Monty at San Diego. And
yeah. Did you know, like Eric Olson or Sean Tiffany or any of those guys at all?
Who's the guy who does the zombie characters? Stan something?
I don't know.
Stan Yan? Stan Yan? I think he's a Boulderite too.
Oh, really?
Boulderinians? Boulder? What do you guys call yourselves up there?
Boulderites.
Comrades?
Masters of the universe? No, I don't know what they call. I think it's Boulderites, maybe.
Comrades?
Brothers.
Yeah, probably.
Sorry, dude. I'm from the other part of Colorado.
Yeah, I didn't, you know, it's funny. I think actually my friend Sean did tell me that about that Stan Yan guy. But I guess I don't know.
He does these zombie characters, but he's got kids books now, which is the thing. Like, okay. If I was smart, I would have started doing kids books years ago.
Yeah. That's pretty cool.
Like, I don't really know who's in the room here. Like, I'm such a neophyte to this kind of stuff that I'm sorry that, guys, that I don't know your body of work or anything, but I'll definitely be digging in after.
Yeah, nobody knows who I am, so it's okay.
I like the sculpting. My kid's actually in a studio arts program up at CSU.
Oh, yeah? Up in Fort Collins?
So, yeah.
That's cool. What part of Colorado do you live in, then?
I live up near Vail.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's cool.
I was one of those hotel kids.
Hotel kids?
Yeah, I worked in hotels my whole life until I got a real job.
Oh, I see. Okay. That's funny. Well, yeah, I'm from Colorado. Mike is also from Colorado.
Oh, yeah?
So two of us. Yeah. He's from down around the Canyon City.
Oh, okay. Cool.
I grew up in Denver, and I've moved down to Southern Colorado about 10 years ago now.
Cool, cool. What part of Denver are you from?
Thornton.
Thornton, yeah, nice, dude. I went to North Glen Junior High School.
Oh, right on.
Yeah, way back in the day.
That's weird. Oh, so you're even local here. That's pretty wild.
Well, yeah, yep, since the early 80s, late 70s.
Yeah. Wow. Okay.
Yeah, I went from Platte Canyon High School to Ojai, California. That's where I met Sergio.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I figured he lived out there somewhere. I'd always see him out there in San Diego, like every year. I'd never go out, so I figured he was from around there somewhere.
Yeah.
Even though a lot of people travel that show, it seemed like there was always like that crew of guys that was just like always there.
Yep. Yep.
So.
Yeah, actually, my very first show was in 90, I think it was 93, and we went as, my buddy Steve and I went as guests to Sergio, and so our name badges said our name and then Sergio's name underneath them, and I would be standing in line to show my art to people, and like Dave Lapham and Jim Shooter would immediately see Sergio's name and drag us behind the table.
Oh, that's cool.
Because we we were Sergio's guys, and it was, dude, it was the VIP treatment all the way. I wish I could have lived up to that. I really do. I wish I could have wound up doing a big comic or something just to make Sergio happy.
It's never too late.
Yeah, dude.
It's true. It is never too late. Thank you very much. And you know what? That's I still dream of, you know, getting my Eisner.
Is that a thing? It is. They still do the Eisner. I'm sure they do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They gave it to, unfortunately, Squirrel Girl.
Like best comic or whatever.
Oh god.
Hey man. What is she? Great Lakes Avenger or something like that? Midwest Avengers.
I don't really care. They destroyed so bad. Oh gosh. Like, she used to be cute, funny. Would take out anything, you know, a little pouch, you know, but now she's, God, now she's like, looks like, sorry to say, but retarded, you know, the artist who draws her is just, oh, so bad. But she won the Will Eisner Award.
Oh, shit. I heard you guys talking about that guy who they did. There's a YouTube video where he traces his own faces and stuff.
Yeah,
that's so funny. When I used to really like wonder how many artists just flat out recycle other people's stuff. It's really, and there's so many guys on YouTube who seem to have really done their like research. You know, I swear to it's one of those things where I'm terrified that somebody might see something and think that I stole it from somewhere else. It terrifies me.
Well, I mean, it's one thing to take inspiration from something else, right? Yeah. It's another thing altogether when you trace over it to get the figure, and then you just kind of redesign the outfit a little bit,
you know? Right?
Yeah.
There's plenty of artists that do like homage, you know, like pay homage to certain artists, and you can tell, and it's obvious, and you know, if it's a cover, they'll sign their name and say, you know, dedicated to or whatever.
Yeah. Ripped from.
Ripped from.
Yeah, they used to do that all the time. I was actually hearing you guys talk about Mignola earlier, and I remember Mignola from the Rocket Raccoon series. Like, he did like furry back in the day. It was super good too.
Yeah, I love that one. That was awesome.
Yeah, killed it. That series is worth a bundle now if you have it.
Oh really?
Oh yeah.
So have you seen the new Squirrel Girl lately?
The comic, no.
Yeah, have any of you guys seen it?
I don't know. I don't even know what you're talking about, buddy.
Oh. So bad. So bad.
I see squirrels out my window.
I've seen some of the reviews online and stuff, but other than that, I haven't really paid any attention to it.
Yeah, like, oh my god. I just want to die every time I open the book.
That means you're buying multiple.
No, I'm not buying. I work at a comic book store.
Oh, okay, cool.
So, I have customers who buy it. I don't know why.
Do you have some sort of like history with Squirrel Girl? It seems to be a sore, kind of a sore subject.
So back in the day, they used to draw really cute and everything. So, can you see my screen right there?
My phone? Yeah,
that's Squirrel Girl right now.
Hold on.
Let me click on you. There you go.
Is that the good one or the?
That's the bad one right now.
Okay.
The return.
It looks like a human. I don't.
Anyways,
you want to?
I think back in the day, she kind of looked like Josie and the Pussycats. You know.
Yeah, she looked a lot cuter. It was a lot more fun. It was like that. So that's the old one.
Oh yeah, that's pretty neat.
Yeah. Cool. So yeah, the new one they gave her like buck teeth. You know, you don't know what gender she is or it is. And
is it like, isn't it a girl still?
Well, I guess. I don't know.
She identifies
as a girl in this world. Act that way. You know, but I'm just all offensive tonight. I know it. But yeah. Brad's digging himself a hole, you know. Yeah.
It's okay.
Yeah. It's just so bad.
You're in the safe zone.
I'm in a safe space.
Yes.
don't know about that. On YouTube.
Yeah, we'll all be doxxed by the end of this video.
Yeah, everybody knows where we live now.
Totally fine. Don't dox them. Yeah. Yeah.
I've always thought that, though, you know, it's just, like, weird how people, like, you know, they talk about doxing and all that kind of stuff. Because I kind of did it, like, right off the bat, you know. So I was always trying to sell stuff, so I wanted everybody to know who I was, you know.
I figure I don't have enough enemies yet, so.
What? I'm sorry, I missed out that
moment. I don't have enough enemies yet, so.
Oh.
It'll all be fine.
Well, I've got a few. I mean, I've been on YouTube for like 7 years now, so it definitely been a few come along.
I remember someone texted me this week, like, hey, we need to get you out there. You need more enemies. That'll get you more popular. I'm like, no, I don't want more enemies. That's not what I want.
I was listening to somebody talk about Venture Brothers. I never watched Venture Brothers, but in the cartoon they assign people arch nemesis.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was that's what we need, somebody to assign us our arch nemesis.
Everybody pair up.
Yeah, in the show, if your arch nemesis is awesome, that means you're awesome.
Oh, that's cool.
So you wanted the best arch nemesis.
I got Kevin Cross. No. Oh,
man. You can have Kevin Cross all you want. I have no idea.
He's never around.
All yeah, right. That's too bad. Create it. More lately, yeah.
Missing
Kevin's videos.
Yeah. He's the creator of the 100s.
Of the what?
The 100 day comic making challenge.
Oh, okay.
He's a very cool guy.
All right.
There you go, vouching again, Pete.
You see how that turned out.
It's all good.
So we're at 45 minutes left. So there you go.
I guess we still got people watching. Drawing long. Is Abe Sapien?
Yeah, Abe's in there for sure. I lost my window. Where was it? Yeah. Craig DeLuca. Says there's 12 people watching, but. Craig Moon November area, too. Yeah.
Is my friend. Says Craig.
That's cool.
I like. Yeah, yeah. No, Stan's a cool guy.
Yeah, I've met him out in San Diego a couple times. He seemed really nice. I was, you know, just kind of, we were talking about, you know, I've seen the comic up at the comic shop here recently. I was kind of really surprised that it was still running, though. And that thing has been around forever.
Which one?
You know, Yosagi Yojimbo.
Oh, yeah, Yosagi. Yeah, he's been doing that for since the 80s or so. He was sort of part of the first, like, part of the furry movement. He was sort of like one of the big major characters back in the day.
Yeah.
He just went through a crazy life change himself. You know, he's an older guy. I think he might be in his late 60s or early 70s. And he, I think he just lost his wife a couple of years ago and just got remarried or something like that.
Oh, wow. That's wild.
The fact that he's doing all of this still is like, him and Sergio are never, they're going to die with pencils in their hands. I know it.
I'm going to.
They're never going to quit.
That's awesome.
I'm going to die with two pencils.
Cool. Yeah. Pencil and electric eraser.
Probably a needle eraser.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I see your Argonus is like, there's another guy that's been around for like ever.
His 82nd birthday. Last summer.
It's pretty crazy.
And he's still going strong too. He's got a lot of properties. He writes gags for movies. And do you know who Walt Dorn is? Walt Dorn. He worked for. I think he did a lot of the like Shrek stuff and SpongeBob SquarePants and stuff. He was one of Sergio's guys too. He's from Ojai and. He lives up in Ojai, and he's a younger guy. But you know, he was the voice of Rumpelstiltskin in that like third or fourth Shrek movie, and he was a Creative Capers guy. He did Nightmare Ned. It was a short run cartoon.
Like a video game series. I think then they have like a video game of that.
Nightmare Ned, probably. I'm sure it got licensed. That was pretty cool.
It's like a storybook kind of deal.
Yeah, maybe.
I remember seeing that in school one time.
The Scholastic stuff, maybe. He was one of the guys. Every now and then you can catch a SpongeBob SquarePants. If you watch the title credits, he's in there. But he was one of those kids who hung out with Sergio too back in the day.
That's awesome.
He was just a really successful one.
Excuse me.
What was your making jokes, Pete? Jesus.
Me.
One of you guys was doing your drawing on a like small scooter.
That's talent right there.
I'm almost home. What was your comic about that you had it when at that con?
It was so bad, dude. It was called the Goon Squad, and it was a
sounds awesome.
It was cyborgs, and I have this whole back. We can, yeah.
Let's hear it.
The Goon Squad was a team of corporate security specialists, and they were cyborgs, and so they protected their corporation from resource depreciation raids by other corporations. So I had this big picture in my head of this world where corporate paramilitary sort of took over, and you know, you had to have the baddest, the coolest, most powerful military force just to sort of compete in the, you know, sort of, what do they call it, dystopian world that they lived in. And so, like, there was, you know, one corporation had cyborgs, another corporation had, like, super soldiers, another corporation had, like, martial arts masters, and... You know,
that's kind of cool.
It almost sounds actually, like Shadowrun.
My friends actually backed it so much that I have a logo and it's a trident, and my friends all got the tattoos later on in life.
Oh man!
Wow.
Yeah.
Did you do the?
Yeah, my boys backed me.
Did you do the tattoos for him?
Sorry.
Did you do the tattoos for him?
No, not a single one. Yeah, they, you know, we split up and we're all over the country, so, and we were getting those tattoos before I ever became a tattoo artist, so
yeah,
that's awesome, man.
I've actually considered writing it and finding somebody to draw it for me, but I'll be honest, I've worked with people in the industry before. I don't know if there's anybody I could trust to do it.
I trust Jeff,
but there's no way Jeff would let me hire him.
Probably not, but you know, that wouldn't mean nothing to you. It's just I just don't want to work for free.
No, I don't need anybody to work for free, man. I make good money.
No, I was just playing.
Told you I'm a tattoo artist. We make money.
Oh, I know you do.
Yeah, that's one of the few artists that work as tattoo artists. So
it was really bizarre. And I stopped going to San Diego Comic-Con in 2004. In 2003, through the Comic-Con, I wound up like becoming friends with Terry Dodson and Aaron Lepresti. You know those guys?
Yeah.
And so this one time, you know, and I'm bragging to my wife. I name drop constantly. So I'm bragging to my wife about, you know, how these guys are big comic book artists now and, you know, like, you know, doing big names. And so we actually get invited to dinner with these guys. So we go out for Thai food with them. And it was Aaron and Terry and then a couple of other artists and me and my wife. And so I'm thrilled because I'm geeking out big time because, you know, like these guys are drawing like Wonder Woman and stuff like that. And we're sitting around the table and I was like 3 or 4 years into my tattoo career. And when they found out that I was doing tattoos, all of the conversation stopped and they all just harassed me about how about tattooing the whole rest of the night. It was awful. It was just a terrible day.
Yeah. Like they were picking on you or they were just like
They were just like fascinated by it. You know, this is 2005 still. I mean, it was we had TV shows and stuff about tattooing back then, but it was still like sort of underground. Yeah, Miami Ink and Ink.
Yep.
And you know, it was still sort of underground at that point. So there's still some real cachet to it. It was still cool.
Uh-huh.
You know. It wasn't just infinity knots and whatever the F else that we do now.
Yeah.
The quote of the day.
Yeah, I mean, I find it tattooing pretty interesting. Different guys I've worked with and stuff have done it, and it's just like they always have good stories, that's for damn sure.
great that I can provide, you know? It's awesome that I could actually draw for a living. I mean, I'm super happy about that. I encourage, you know, if you guys have any desire to do it, you know.
Do you have any work we can see at yours?
Yeah, I mean, if you guys have Instagram, I could give you my Instagram. Or...
Yeah. Which Instagram?
It's super lame.
Super light?
Lame.
Oh, lame.
It's really easy.
Give yourself some credit, man.
I think it's J. It's not. I don't think it's J U Z.
Oh, I was looking up super lame. I was like, what?
Oh, no. NAR10. Like the numbers? Like just 10, Martin, like this? Is my camera backwards?
Oh, I'm sorry.
It comes out fine when you pulled it up. It's fine.
Okay. Yeah.
Just put it up there again.
Put it up there again. Yeah.
There we go. Now everybody can see that. J-U-Z.
Just 10.
Martin. Okay. M-A-R-10.
I'll throw a link in the show notes after we forget.
Gotcha.
People watching this later can check it out.
Well, and then my the poses is pose reference at pose reference on Instagram.
What is pose reference?
Oh, dude,
I guess I don't understand. Like, what?
That's killer.
Is it like photographed nudes or something?
Let me get a book. Hold on. So what I do, okay. I purchase reference photography. So all these poses are reference because they're going to be used as reference. I wanted to keep it obvious or, you know, keep it really close. So this was the Kickstarter version. It's a 300.
I have a PDF of your book.
Yeah. You do?
It's like, wait a sec.
So this is the kind of stuff I do.
Now I get it.
All right. Yeah.
Like that.
Nice.
So these are all like right from photo reference or these little dolls that I get from Armature 9.
Oh, look at that, Mike. Go back to that little doll thing.
Oh, dude, that Bane piece is sick. Oh.
Come on, that's sweet, man. What was that for? Is that for like a stop motion thing or?
It's an Armature 9.
Here. Oh, okay. That guy. Oh, he had his own Kickstarter, right?
Yeah, he was. He's not anymore.
That's awesome, man.
So good.
Wow, dude, your tattoos are awesome, dude.
Dude, thank you. That's seriously cool of you to say, man. I do appreciate that.
Yeah, like, okay, this main piece is super sick. I love the shoulder piece with the Celtic knots on it.
Oh, thank you, dude. Thank you.
Dude.
Super cool.
I have several friends who are tattoo artists, and so I love tattoos. I'll just never get one. Oh, that tree
they're is not, they're not for everybody. I don't have many, honestly. I really don't. Personally.
You freehanded the tree. That's nice, dude.
Yep.
Yeah, I can. I like tattoos a lot. I like, you know, I'm a fan of them, but it's like I don't have any.
Just yeah, the other like reason I want. Tattoos is, I'm honestly, on women, I'd probably just touch too much and I get myself in trouble. I'm just going to be honest with it. You know, I can't do it. Yeah.
I just look at it like, you know, so many pieces that I do and I like, and then, you know, 2 years later I look at it and I just can't stand it. I wouldn't want to, like, wake up every day and to stare at the same
thing. Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, for sure. And that's, I'm definitely, well, you know what? I go back and forth. Like, some of mine are really meaningful to me, and other ones were people who just go, who are just like, hey, do you want to do this today? I'm like, yeah, whatever. I ain't got nothing better to do. Yeah. You know, and so I let them tattoo, you know, like, let my apprentice tattoo me or something like that, but.
That lion head on the chick is dope too. That's so neat, dude.
Oh, thanks, dude.
Sorry, man.
No. I finally got to start doing tattoos that I'm really into, like that anime sleeve. I don't know if that's on there or not. But like, I've done these big anime sleeves and stuff, and it's just like, I did a whole sleeve of Venomized characters, like Marvel characters. Oh, really? It was sick, and they were all, most of them were custom too, which is made me super happy.
That's neat.
Oh, animal. That's cool. Muppets animal. Yeah, I'm not seeing the anime sleeve at all.
I might have not posted it.
Okay, I don't know why you do that to your own hand. The bones on the hand.
Yeah, there's just sometimes when you have to just go, fine, I'll take your money and do what you want me to do.
Yeah.
It can be rough sometimes.
Yeah, you know they're making a bad choice. Be like,
really?
But at the same time, I want them to do the best bad choice they can do.
Yeah. Better in my hands than somebody else's. Yeah.
So Abe says, where do we send our pics? Just, do you want to just send it to me on Facebook? That would be like an easy way. Or you could stick it in the Artcasters. That's my easiest. But anybody who's not on Facebook, just go friend me on Twitter and then direct message me. So. Abe's done. How much time do we got? I'm like really lagging behind today.
We're just about done, I think.
Well, no, we got 30 minutes.
I had a long day. I'm feeling like the end of my day soon.
Yeah, yeah, kind of like mine. That's what I feel. Oh.
And man, it's like, you know, it's fall now, and for a while the temperature went down, but this week we're in, it's like the temperature's up in the 80s again. It's like, oh, enough already.
Oh, dude, we got 50s here right now in Utah because of the rain.
We
had a tropical storm move up from, there's a hurricane in Mexico and it broke up and the water just came straight to us, which is good because we have like massive forest fires going on. So
Now you do?
Not anymore. They just got done.
Yeah, that big fire over near Aspen was just over the hill from my house, and it sort of choked us out when we were over there.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that sucks.
Like Colorado's always on fire. Really
Seems that way. Colorado, Utah, and California. Let's all see how much we can burn.
Yeah. I'm in North Dakota right now. Like, I'm up in Minot, like, working for the next couple of weeks, and it dumped snow today.
What?
Wow.
Yeah, dumped. It was awful.
What do you do in North Dakota then?
Tattoo.
Oh, okay. And you live in Colorado then? So you kind of go up there once in a while and then come back? Or?
Well, I try and be up here about 2 or 3 weeks a month.
Oh, okay.
I got a really cool family, so it was super easy for me to travel. Like, you know, my kids were no problem. My wife is totally cool. And so it was easy for me to come up here and do this and then go home and do nothing, you know?
Yeah.
Got to, like, hang out with my dogs and hang out with horses and stuff like that. So
that's cool.
But now that we're empty nesters, I don't know what to frickin' do with myself anymore.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not, you know, like, I'm paying for college again, which is weird, but.
Yeah, that sucks.
I never personally did college, so I never, I don't feel bad paying for the kids' college, you know?
Yeah. What are your kids wanting to do?
My daughter was in hospitality and tourism. She graduated a couple of years ago. She's working for Hyatt now, and my son is in the arts program.
You told me that. College, sorry.
Yeah. So studio, like, art.
Okay. Is that like the fine arts program, or what would that be?
Yeah, it would be the fine arts program.
Okay.
Yeah. So
that's cool. I bet that's pretty pricey though.
It's at a state school, man. Colorado
practically. Oh, right. You guys are in state. Yeah.
What's weed money? So there's plenty of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's cool, though. I mean, sounds like a good deal.
Makes me happy. You know, he wants to, you know, he's actually into fashion. So, you know, at some point he'll create his own clothing line, and hopefully I'll just go work for him, get out of this racket.
Yeah.
Abe had rain for 2 days straight, flooding, and the dam on the reservation almost failed. Crazy.
Which one?
I don't know what dam he has in his area. What reservation are you talking about, Abe?
Failed in Arizona.
He's in Arizona.
Really?
Yeah.
That's nuts. I think I'm done with mine. No, I know I'm done.
you get 24 minutes today.
That's what I get for being sick.
Yeah.
That looks really good,
man. Well, you made it.
Thanks, bro.
You cruise right through that thing.
I just kind of had this idea when we put the two together. I'm like, oh, okay. So what was it? Would I change some things? Yeah, probably. Yeah. I think I would love to give them if we did another mashup, make them riding a rabbit bike instead.
That'd be neat.
Yeah. So, like, he's pulling the ears and stuff like that for his, what do they call that? The law bike? No, the...
It's just a dread bike.
No, they have a name for it.
The truth cycle. It's,
truth cycle.
Yeah. I was never, like, a big Judge Dredd fan.
I wasn't either, but I love the artwork, though. I love the post-apocalyptic kind of mega-city look, you know?
Yeah.
I think the only Dredd I read were, like, the DC comics ones.
Yeah, like when he crossed over with Batman and stuff.
Yeah.
The old AD 2000 books were great, man. Those were so good. British comics back in the day were so good.
I liked a lot of them. I don't know.
Yeah.
There was some that I didn't like so much. It depends.
Like Rogue Trooper and stuff like that was all part of it.
Yeah.
Hey, Pete, yours is looking pretty good there, buddy.
Thanks. It needs more work, but I'm not going to do it tonight. I am tired.
Justin's ain't bad either.
I actually get to draw something other than a tattoo. That's nice.
There you go. How's cool. Mike's coming along?
That's coming along pretty good.
The sculpture?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, okay. I see it now. Oh, nice.
It's freaking awesome.
That is really nice.
That's awesome. I was hoping to get to paint it, but sounds like there won't be too much time for that.
So, yeah, Abe's posted on the Artcaster page. I'll grab it here when we hit the end.
You can paint it tomorrow?
No, I probably won't.
A realist. You gotta love people like that.
He'll repurpose the clay and make something else.
Make something work. Make something that's normal, you know?
I mean, I would probably paint it right now, but I don't. If there was enough time, I still might try to throw some color on it. How much time is left?
That's Scopely, right?
So 20 like minutes. Yeah, it's probably Scopely, I think.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Oh, you're good, dude. No worries.
Just, yeah.
I remember when I was a kid, my friend, I lost touch with him, but we lived in Seattle. His name was Jesse Fish, and we're both into artwork and stuff, but he made little sculptures out of Scopely of birds, like parrots and stuff.
Uh-huh.
And so he would go sell them at the flea market on the weekends and make a bunch of money. He was good at it. I'm like, damn, man. You know, but every time I tried to sculpt it, like, what came out? But he was good at it. So I tried looking him up years later, but
yeah.
He's also the best G1 Transformers set I ever saw when I was a kid. He was an only kid, so he got spoiled.
Yeah. Only kids are the worst.
And he had his own laser disc player in his room.
Holy crap.
Wow. Yeah, he watched Ghostbusters on it. It was pretty cool. Yeah.
Laser discs were so great.
Yeah. G1 is definitely the best, that's for sure. Did you guys see the new Bumblebee trailer, right? The G1 designs are in there. I thought that was pretty cool. Yeah, so G1. Like, yeah, so Soundwave, what's the other one?
Oh,
Shockwave? It was the gun who was always on Cybertron, the other gun. The diamond shaped head, and yeah, he was pretty cool.
I know. I know. Bumblebee is directed by Travis Knight, who is a big, huge animator at Leica. His dad is the owner of Nike.
Oh, okay.
What did he do?
He's Travis Knight. He's that really good animator at Leica.
Yeah, I know. But what did he do with Transformers though?
Oh, he's directing Bumblebee.
Oh, he did? Okay.
That's cool.
It's coming up. It's not out yet.
Yeah. I like the way the look. I love the look, though, of Bumblebee, too. It's the old VW bug, you know, so.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of neat.
But I'm kind of sad there's not going to be Starscream, you know, as far as we can tell on Earth, as the F-15, which is kind of sad. That was my favorite toy, so.
Yeah.
Gotta love the Jets.
Are the Transformer movies, like, better now? I mean, they were horrible for a while. I mean, I remember seeing the first one and kind of liking it, but.
Oh, all the rest were trash.
Everybody just trashes them all the time.
I'm kind of waiting for this one, but we'll see.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Oh, yeah, they had Ravager on there, too. The little tape that shot out a sound wave. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's right. It was like a vulture, right?
He was a dog. A dog.
Oh, he's a dog, right.
Yeah, there was a vulture, which was Screech. I think it was Screech. And then they had Rumble, who would pop out, and he would, you know, he'd do the little things on the ground to make it all rumble on the ground. So, yeah. I'm hoping that the Constructicons will be there. Like the old school ones or some Insecticons or something. Yeah. I don't know. We'll see, though. But Daredevil is next week. Right, Pete? We're excited.
Yeah, I just saw the newest trailer. It's going to be probably the best of the series of all the different series, I think. I'm really excited about it.
Daredevil?
Yeah, yeah. The Daredevil season 3.
Oh, okay.
It's like a Daredevil Kingpin arc, and it looks really good.
Yep. D'Onofrio does such a good Kingpin. Oh my god.
Yeah.
I don't know. I still liked, what's his name in the movie? Who died?
Michael Clark Duncan.
Yeah, Michael Clark Duncan. His charisma, though, and stuff. I thought. D'Onofrio. He is good.
He's good. Like, he's okay.
He's not bad.
No, I love him. I think he's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, big white guys with presence that, it's kind of a fat size and big and, strong. So,
Don't insult him.
I am 6'3", 500 pounds. So,
This is my picture from the Denver Comic Con. This.
Let me click on you.
So me and a cosplayer who played as Kingpin, dude. The guy killed it.
Yeah, he's nice. Perfect.
Right? Oh my god, he was so good.
Yep. I've always wondered that about cosplayers. Like, why don't you dress up what your body type will allow?
Right, yeah.
Because I've seen some horrible things. I'm like, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Like, I
track down Lebowski's most of the time, like this.
That's a pretty good one, too.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
There's some good ones. But yeah, dressing for your body type, absolutely. There shouldn't be. We used to play a Comic Con bingo Comic Con scavenger hunt. And we, you'd get certain. But we come up with all the okay, so you got to find, you got to find a Deadpool, and then you got to find a Deadpool and a Spider-Man together, and then you got to find a fat Batman, and then you got to
find funny. Oh my gosh.
Yep. There's always one.
There is. That's very true. Yeah. Oh, so I was at Las Vegas Comic Con, was it not this year, but last year. And so I was splitting the table with my buddy Tyler, who's writing Handyman. And, it was his first convention where he had his own table. No, it was actually his second. But in Las Vegas, with cosplay, he never seen, he's never saw like the body painting girls, where it's just body paint only. And, we're from Utah, and, he's. He's pretty conservative, And so the third day, there's a table across from us where it wasn't being used. So we were sharing a table because we didn't know how the show was going to go. So we split the tables. And then I'm on one side, he's on the other. And then all the girls come running down the con who were all in body paint only, bouncing up and down and everything right in front of him. And his face was just like, his jaw was dropped. He's like, oh my gosh. And we're all laughing at him. He's like, what? He's like, your face, dude, it's hilarious. And then they go running by again, and it just drops again. And then he thought they were done running by, so he starts doing his little magic tricks to get people to come over the table. And then the really big, heavy-chested Thor came by. Oh, and dude, he was just like, oh my god. He just turned around and looked at the wall. Oh, it was so funny. His face. Oh, we couldn't stop laughing at him. Oh,
what did he have at the table?
So he did this book called Demons, which is on Kickstarter right now, because he was with Insane Comics and they went under. And
right, yeah, I heard that.
So he did a whole series with Demons for him, and he was selling his books there with it with me. So we split the cost of the table because we never went to Las Vegas before, and but it ended up turning out good and bad at the same time, because like we didn't make any money, but we broke even.
That's cool.
Because we got my stuff's like PG-13 maybe normally that I sell at the show. His is more PG, and right next to us was what's his name? Daniel. He draws Zombie Tramp. The book, yeah. So he's a cool guy, but you know, his girlfriend was all dressed super skimpy, and there was TNA everywhere. And so all the kids would start looking at my stuff, and then the parents would put on the blinders and keep walking, you know. So like I couldn't sell nothing. He felt so bad. Daniel Mendoza, that's who it is. And so he was a cool dude, but it kind of sucked because we were like, his fans too were also like so lined up, they were just blocking our table.
Man, that sucks.
That's all right though. He's a cool dude. Yeah. I like him. Yeah. You know, I saw him actually out of Long Beach when I was out there losing money. So,
yeah. Well, proper con placement is definitely key to having a great convention.
It definitely is. I agree.
Yeah.
Being right next to or in the line of something that is super popular is always key. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Very true. Except when the stuff clashes with yours.
Right.
But, yeah, Daniel's cool, though, when I saw him at Long Beach. I drew a Zombie Tramp for him and gave it to him. And we got to talk again for a while. He felt so bad.
Hey, Mike, I muted you when your airbrush was going, so you got to unmute yourself. I went to click you unmute, and you got to do it. So just letting you know whenever you start talking again. So, all right, go ahead. You might have been. I didn't even think that, you know. I had him in timeout or something. Yeah, I just heard you. All
right. Don't put Mike in the corner.
Right. Last time I went to a con, they had a Deadpool conga line running through the whole event, grabbing any Deadpool they found. Yeah, they always do that. Those and Harley Quinn. I hate those two characters.
I've like, always hated Deadpool, but the movies are so good.
They are. I just hate the cosplay.
Yeah.
Like the only costume they have to. It's like, oh.
Yeah. I was just in Vegas.
I saw that last weekend. Year. Yeah.
I was just in Vegas last weekend for a wedding, and we were driving down the freeway in Las Vegas, and there's some motorcycle ripped past me with a guy wearing a Deadpool costume. It was awesome. It really was so cool.
You ever did you ever go out to Torpedo Comics out there?
The Torpedo Comics, is that a
comic Las shop? Vegas?
Is that a shop or?
Oh yeah, it's a shop. It's a high end comic shop.
I have not. I've been to a couple like sort of out in the burbs, but no, I've not even heard of Torpedo.
Yeah, so Torpedo is run by the drummer from System of the Downed, and he's best friends with Jim Lee. And so yeah, you just stop by. You never know who's gonna be in the store. It's kind of interesting. And like the other weekend they had Jay Lee doing a signing for a variant cover of Max and Batman crossover that just came out.
Really?
And you know, Sam Keith walks in the door, sits down, and starts signing books with him.
Oh my god.
What the heck?
Yeah. So cool.
Yeah. And then like if Jim gets bored, he'll just drive over And then they'll take a picture of them with them in the shop and everything. Like, what the heck, you know? Yeah. But they do okay. these cool signings. You can go see everybody, too. It's pretty neat. There for that. Yeah, so Jim's going to be there, I think, December. We're planning on going down. A bunch of us are. So,
so was that, like, far from the strip?
Kind yeah, of it's place? Not even on the strip. Yeah. At all. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, which is nice.
I've only been to Vegas. I hate the strip.
I hate downtown Las Vegas.
Why is that?
I'm just not super crowds and you know all those you know I don't know.
Wait, you don't get a crowd if you're walking outside.
Yeah, I guess. I don't know. I just something about the strip down. I don't like it. You know, but. I like Henderson area. I like the outside of Las Vegas, like the all the suburbs and stuff. It's really cool. Just downtown.
Suburbs. Oh my god.
Oh my god, dude! I think I've driven probably driven past this Torpedo Comics like 10 times.
Yeah, it's inconspicuous. But
oh my god, that's so crazy! Actually, my wife goes and gets. There's a juice place sort of around the corner that my wife like craves and she constantly goes, you know what? I'm seriously bummed right now.
Dude, yeah. Go by there, man. That's a cool shop. So, and they have they do a lot of grading comics there. And they have a vault section in the back. Like, I was there 3 or 4 weeks ago. Like, X-Men number 1 was in the vault. Amazing Spider-Man 15. Fantastic Four number 1. Batman number 2. They got so many books. Like, it's just, it's awesome.
Yeah. It sort of bums me out. I have friends who live in Vegas and they've never even mentioned this place.
Really?
Man. Yep.
I'd be there every week.
Just catching shit from now on. Sorry.
Yeah, I think we're all over.
Oh, it's like
that's how angry I am.
You haven't been to Torpedo.
I swear on the screen.
You know, just because they live there doesn't mean they know everything.
These are comic nerds. They should know this. Oh, pardon my language. Don't kick me.
Yeah, I think what they have Greg Capullo doing a signing here coming up.
That's cool. In San Diego, or not in San Diego, in Denver this year, I stopped at Tony Moore's booth. Yeah. You know who I'm talking about? The guy who originally did like the
run on. And
yeah, yeah. And, you know, he did a lot of the Walking Dead stuff back in the day. In Cleveland, and he's opening a tattoo shop in Cleveland.
That's wild.
So I might get the guest spot in his shop. That would be great. It would be so great. I would work there honestly just to hang out with that guy. That's so cool.
Apes is very cool drawings, everybody.
He was a real nice guy. I remember him like back in the day in like San Diego when like, you know, he was like a nobody. We would all be standing in the line showing our shit, you know what I mean?
Yep.
He was a real nice guy.
I forget why. I think maybe I just mentioned. I messaged him on Facebook or something, because I heard he was living in Kentucky and I just moved here years ago. And
yeah.
And he, you know, he's like, "Don't tell anybody," but it's very close to where you are, or something to that effect. And he was just really cool. He was like, you know,
what's name?
Yeah. My daughter went to UK, and so we got to know, is it Cincinnati or Cleveland that's just sort of north of Kentucky?
You're okay, Abe. Don't worry about your spelling.
Ohio is, it's northeast of me, I guess.
Is it that? Okay, I better check my map. My map here. It's either Cleveland or
Cleveland's like north.
Cincinnati, right? Yeah.
Okay.
So I guess he must be in Cincinnati because that's where he's talking about putting that shop.
Right.
Him and his wife are in out.
Yeah, so Torpedo Comics, upcoming signings, which is cool. Greg Capullo, October 20th. Always wanted to meet the guy.
Yes.
Here's the one I'm looking forward to, November 17th and 18th. 17th is Roberto Ramos and Greg Horn. And then 18th is Adam Hughes.
Oh.
And then December 8th is the big one. Jim Lee, Scott Williams, Alex Schneider, Alex Sinclair, sorry, and Mark Silvestri.
Holy crap.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
It's yeah. Cool. And they have a cool system worked out, too. Because it's a smaller shop, so they can't fit everybody in. What you do is you go in early in the morning, grab a name tag or a number tag, right? Mm-hmm. And then you can leave the shop. And then your number is good for whatever the whole day. And then just on Facebook, they update the numbers. Hey, now doing these guys, come on back to the shop. And even if you come late, if you have that number and on another number set, you got to go right to the front of the line. So,
that's amazing.
They should text you like a restaurant.
I think a lot of people text.
Your table is ready.
Vibrating buttons or whatever.
Yeah. The cool thing, though, is they have other passes. They have a VIP pass and then a gold VIP pass. So you had to pay $1,000 for the gold VIP pass. Guarantees you 5 signatures per person. And you get to have the lunch with the artists.
Oh, dude. I wonder what that costs.
Yeah. It was $1,000.
Jeez.
Yeah.
For the day?
Well, yeah. So you get to go right to the front of the line. Gold is always first. You get all the signatures you want, or the 5 from each artist, and you can pay like $10 extra for each one. And then you get to have lunch with them. They take a 2-hour lunch break in the middle of the day, and you all meet together and go have it at a restaurant. So it's pretty cool.
Really? Yeah.
And then there's a regular VIP pass, which is just $200. Gets you 3 signatures per person, and then that's one that most people have. You just come throughout the day. And at the very end is the freebies, but you have to be like there, stand in line forever. So, yeah, cause it's first come, first serve for that one.
I don't charge nearly enough.
I think they're going to raise it next year. That's what they're saying. That's what the rumor's going around. Because I think they got some big plans for next year. So.
God, is it bad to say that I'd probably pay that $1,000?
I probably
to hang out with Jim Lee and Scott Williams. Oh my God, Silvestri! That's
awesome. Yeah.
Does he still draw comics?
Thanks for coming by, buddy. You have a good night, dude.
Who left?
Is that Abe?
No, Abe's still.
Who is it?
Animate Clay.
Animate Clay.
Oh, yeah, Mark. Cool, man. Thanks for watching.
See ya.
See ya, Mark. So let me see. So it's the last 5 minutes. I don't know if you guys heard me say the 5-minute warning. And let's check out Abe's art.
The camera's pretty grainy.
Where did you say you put it? Oh, you put it in the Artcasters?
He said the Artcasters group.
Maybe Pete can put it on his.
I think Pixel put his drawing on Twitch or Twitter.
I'll go grab it. My computer's responding slowly to try.
Used all day. A couple of streams, a few video calls.
Yeah. My computer's tired like I am.
All right, I got Abe's here. Let's check it out. Oh, wait a minute.
Oh, you got it?
No, wait. There's actually another one. This guy Lester Argo is in here also. Is that it? Let me go back to the front worker. Okay. All right, I'll screen share. Let's see. Let me click on my window.
Yeah. Ooh, the infinite windows. Oh, that's cool.
Oh, nice.
Awesome.
An awful lot like the same pose as Justin's doing.
Which one is
it? It is kind of.
Yeah.
Oh, well, it's from the poster. No, that's from the poster.
Oh,
yeah, it's. Oh, yeah, yeah, it's from the poster. The movie poster. That's okay. The pose.
Mm. So that's Lester Argo. So thanks for
wow, that's sweet.
Looks great, Lester.
Yeah, boy, him and awesome. I are rock, yeah. Like identical. That's
great. Lines, here, huh? Here's
someone's tracing that poster.
Then here's somebody.
oh, good one.
Did like a little sketch, and then here's the finish.
Oh, wow.
Oh, that was great, man.
Nice work.
Yeah, dude, you did a good job.
I like how you got the eyes and the helmet and stuff, so yeah. It really, you know, is a crossover.
I like how he has the tufts of hair coming out the side of the helmet.
And then he's got the rabbit shoulder pad where, like, Dredd has the eagle. That's really cool.
Oh, he gets my vote.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Good job, guys.
Abe's really good.
Yeah.
Abe rocks, man.
Yeah.
Where's my window at now? Okay.
Greg Land, Abe.
So does anybody else, if anybody else has put their art somewhere that they want me to see it, put it in the chat so that, put their, you know, just tell me in the chat where it is so I can go find it. And Largo says I didn't trace the poster. The guy's standing there.
You were tracing just the screen. That's what you were doing.
No.
Yeah. And then, yeah, that's it. Let's see. Cool. Yeah, if anybody else has got some, just holler. So I'm not that good at finding stuff on Twitter.
Well, once we have
me, I'm not that good.
When did you have a name for the show besides versus everybody?
I forgot what you guys wanted to call it last time, so I just put that.
Oh, on. I had no idea.
What was your idea? You had an idea.
Yeah, I don't remember.
Come on.
Skit. well, mashup is, you know, what it is.
Mashup, yeah.
Okay. So, like, sketch mashup challenge or something?
I
don't remember.
Crossover something.
I like challenge because challenge is definitely searched on YouTube. So, we got to keep challenge.
Mm-hmm. So, mashup challenge?
Ooh, good one.
Superhero mashup challenge. I like that actually. I'll have to get some views. Maybe. If I knew what fucking got views, I'd actually get views.
I think we all did. We need enemies. That's what we need, man. We need enemies.
Yeah. Arch nemesis.
We gotta get the drawn and quartered guys pissed off.
Drawn and quarterly?
No, drawing quarter is taken. That's the comics get guys get together and fight it out. So with artwork, yeah.
I thought there was a company called Drawing Quarterly.
Yeah,
there was.
Yeah.
Was it an old RPG company?
No, it was a comics company.
Iron Challenge.
Iron Challenge.
Like Iron Chef.
Yeah.
Yeah, Hell's Kitchen, Hell's Comics.
Jeff's Kitchen.
Beat Bobby Flay.
What the hell challenge? What the hell is this?
What the hell?
That's the first question everybody asks when they get in there. What is it? What are you guys doing?
You know what? Let's just do it. What the hell is this?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. We'll figure it out.
Who picks this?
You'll be a surprise in the next episode.
So anyway, who's done? Let's take a look at some art, because actually the alarm just went off. That's the end. Unless somebody wants to go another 5 minutes, I'm going to give another five.
I'm good.
I'm not going to finish this in the next 5 minutes.
I'm not going to finish it. It's done at the moment.
I'll take the 5 minutes.
Okay. Talk some more.
As he's putting the finishing touches on, because that looks sick. The sculpture.
It does.
I think he wins.
That's amazing that you get that much done, dude.
He's got my vote.
Yeah. That is crazy.
Thanks, guys.
He's got the wash and the fur. I love it.
Yeah.
He's blow drying it. All right.
Totally.
Really good, Brad. I like yours.
Oh, thanks, this bro.
Giant shoulder pad thing.
Everybody's killing.
I was trying to go. I want to keep the top though.
I'm sorry.
Everybody got really quiet.
Yeah. I think Brad was talking, but then he dropped off.
Oh, did I?
Oh.
Yeah, I didn't hear any of that last bit there.
Oh, I said I was trying to keep the samurai, like, what's it called? Go, wherever the top is that they wear.
Like a top knot or something?
No, I want to keep the top knot as well, which is why I had the ears coming out the helmet, but talk about the outfit. So, I thought that was kind of cool.
Yeah.
So I was trying to do that with the shoulder pads and stuff like that. So, yeah. But it's all good.
Yeah, it looks good. Did everybody do the ears at the top? I'm trying to see yours, Pete. I can't see yours coming out the top, though.
What? You can't see the top?
No, your camera's real fuzzy and
it's a little bit digitized.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. Turn it over. I flipped it, the drawing around, so I could see the top of it better. Well, there we go. Yeah.
There you go.
Oh.
Where it gets, okay. Yeah. That's awesome.
Cool.
Let me see. Oh, nice, Pete.
Thanks.
I had it locked on Jeff's camera. I forgot you could, like, click on everyone's.
Oh, we can?
Oh. Yeah, I totally forgot we can do.
Yeah.
If you guys click it, you know, it's just your screen. But then if it's like, if I click, then it goes to you guys.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
It's
kind
of cool.
Right. Yeah, I forgot all about that. Jeff did an awesome piece, too.
Comic Book Bob. Yes, it is Yusaki Ojimbo and Judge Dredd combo this week.
Well, that's cool.
Yeah.
Somebody guessed it.
Yeah.
That should be the challenge. That should be the challenge. We come up with a mashup and see who gets it first.
Yeah. Totally.
Actually, yeah.
That would give everyone an advantage though, wouldn't it?
Well no. So we should put a straw poll out. There's a site called Straw Polls. And Jeff could put it out early in the morning. Let people vote. So about 30 minutes before we begin, we can see the straw poll, see who wins. So, and then...
That's awesome.
We could just guess. Or they could guess. Yeah.
Yeah, but then they wouldn't be able to draw along.
So. That's true. We like them drawing along. Participation sport. Yeah, I'm getting tired. Holy crap.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, we're all old and tired.
I am tired.
Abe says we should name it the Chibi Manga Anime Art Challenge Super Artist Corner. That's a pretty good one.
A little long. Should we name it?
What are you guys doing this weekend? Who's going to, is anybody going to the Albuquerque con? Me and Mike are going down to Albuquerque to a convention down there.
Nope.
No?
No, I'm working.
It's not this weekend, though. It's some. It's.
No, it's the end of, it's in November. We could get into it, so we thought we'd go for it.
Albuquerque was there in November? I know Tucson's in November. When's Albuquerque?
Oh, is it? Oh, no, I've got them mixed up. Tucson, right?
Yeah, Tucson's like the first, second, third, or something like that.
No, that's not right. I think it's Albuquerque.
That's actually, or is it? It's both, actually.
No, it's because I'm supposed to pay my table fee for Tucson. I can't do it. So I'm gonna have to cancel. So, But yeah, that one's the first week in November.
Yeah, I'll be danged. This is the one we're going to. Yeah, we're going to that one. Or we're going to Albuquerque. So.
Oh, okay. I thought Tucson would be nice. A couple of my friends have been there a couple of times. They say it's a good show. So.
Well, that's cool.
And it's not very big though. Yeah, it's like 10,000 to 20,000 people, but Everybody's really cool though. So, yeah.
It's only 10,000 to 20,000 for Albuquerque?
Uh-huh. No, Tucson.
How big is Albuquerque?
I don't know.
I thought they were bigger than that.
Yeah, I don't know. There were a couple we could get into quick, so we thought we'd just go for it.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah.
You'll have your books on hand, right?
Yeah, I'm going to have my books by then, so kind of wanted to hit one while I had the chance, I guess.
Yeah, do it. You have to get to Salt Lake.
Yeah, we signed up for the waiting list or mailing list or whatever that is, so we'll see. But I don't know. I'm going to try to get back into Denver, but who knows.
I will talk to my people over there and see if...
Your people, okay.
I'm not joking. I know Dan Farr. You know, we've gotten along pretty well, so He runs the show, so I'll see if him or Ryan can get you as a guest. So,
oh, well, that'd be awesome. They want to do that.
And if you guys want to get into Denver, just let me know. I can bug my peeps down there too. So,
pull the strings, man. Let's do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We can all go as a group.
That'd be right.
Peter out here too.
That's what, yeah, I'd love to get Pete out here. That'd be awesome.
We'll get four tables right next to each other. You know.
Oh my god.
That'd be so much fun.
Live stream. Yeah, we can live stream from the show.
Oh god. I have enough trouble live streaming from my room.
Reporting live.
I know in Salt Lake they don't block your phone access, at least. So.
Yeah.
That's like crazy. Long Beach. Yeah.
I'm amazed they did that and actually thought that was fine.
They can block your cell phone signal inside the Long Beach Convention Center?
Yeah, except for emergency calls. So all you can
that is in- so lame.
That's really messed up.
Yeah.
So,
how did they expect you guys to sell stuff? I mean,
buy their Wi-Fi for $90 a day.
Oh, that's what it was.
Wow.
Yeah. It was one of those deals.
Yeah. So, I was like, I barely had enough money to get out to the show. I don't have another $100 a day just to spend on your Wi-Fi.
Did they let you know about that? Like. Right,
no, so all it said in the material that I got was, we're not responsible for cell phone signals, or you may have trouble with it. You know, use at your own risk or whatever. That's all they said. Mad Entertainment stuff that I got sent. So they said, and then they put in there, if you want to use Wi-Fi, you know, sign up here. I'm like, well, why would I do that? You know, my service is out there. It's fine. And when I got there the first day to set up, it worked fine on the floor. No problems. But yeah, once we, there was no overcrowding or overcharging over there at Abe. It was, the attendance was pretty poor as well. So, but 5 o'clock, the last day, as soon as the show's over, your cell phone signal turned back on. You're like, what the heck? I was like, dude.
That's super lame.
Yeah, that's all I knew was actually locked. I was like, kidding me? First, I was like, all right, this is a bummer, you know. And I mean, none of the customers wanted to buy anything because it was a hassle because you had to run all the way out the door to the. Out, as soon as you cross the door, you got cell phone service.
Whoa. So,
yeah. So as soon as you cross that door, you'd have to run out there every time for every transaction. And nobody wanted to do that. So, yeah. It was I lost $700 at that show. It sucked. So,
it's like, yeah. you had to get a cell boy.
What was that, Pete?
You had to get a cell boy.
Somebody cell boy. Outside and... cell boy with a go kart so you could put all the people on there too. They could run over and sign the cards outside. Yeah. So, yeah, it's true. It's funny too. So security wouldn't let you back in the door either. Lock out the door. You had to go all the way around the end. And I'm like, my booth is right there. Right there. It says. Says on your badge right there, vendor. Like, sorry, you can't go back in this door, sir. I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, it was dumb. So
this sounds like a horrible con.
Yeah, I didn't have time. So
cross that one off the list, Jeff.
The only thing good was the beach. That was the only thing good when I was there because I haven't seen the beach in a long time. So
yeah.
You just spent all 3 days out there. At the beach,
no doubt.
I would have spent less money. Yeah, a lot less.
But, yeah.
Now, Emerald City is a good con. That's a good con. That's a big convention.
Yeah, that one might be kind of hard to get into.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I went to C2E2 a couple of years ago. I really like that. I like Chicago though.
Hmm. Yeah.
I've done Chicago. It's fun.
Boy, those people get into their cosplay. It's like Denver. Denver, those cosplayers in Denver are epic.
Dude, man, I love that sculpture, dude. That's cool.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, it looks awesome, dude.
Thanks, buddy. Appreciate it.
Mail that to Jeff, put on his wall. So every art cast is there when you see it. Like, hey, that's mine.
That is awesome. Oh my god.
Yeah.
So jealous.
I really wish I could have done more at the paint job, but
no, you did awesome, dude.
2 hours. I mean, man.
That's seriously impressive.
Yeah, you won hands down tonight, bro.
You and Abe Sapien.
Abe Sapien, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that came out cool.
The lighting's not that great.
Hold it up just a little higher because like the bottom, there you go, the icons are kind of blocking. I wanted to see the badge and stuff.
I bet you as your natural light, it'll look really, really good. Yeah.
That's really cool. Good job, man. Let's check out Justin's. You about done, Justin?
Yeah, all of my Copics are like over at the shop, so I'm using these old Tombos from like 20 years ago. I'm just.
Well, they still have. They still have ink left in them from that long.
Yeah, well, you see, they're drying out. Like, they're half of them are dried out. And they don't mix at all. It's so bad.
It's really nice piece.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, it's cool. I like the way he's drawing his sword. That's very samurai.
Yeah. I like the.
I like how he has a gun in his left hand, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate you guys letting me jump into this. That took a huge leap of, I don't know, guts. You guys are crazy.
Well, Pete vouched for you, so.
I saw your already friends with me on Facebook, so.
That sounds like a familiar name. It rhymes. I ain't no better.
Cool. We got Brad's, which looks great.
Oh, yeah.
Love the detail. Super cool. You guys rock it with the markers. I'm amazed how quickly you can draw with those things.
Markers are great. The mixing is pretty good, too, on the Copics. So yeah. As long as you work it while it's wet. Yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've thought about trying to get some, but I don't know. I just never get around to it.
You know, I was over in Japan this spring, and Copics are like $2.99 or $2 a piece over there.
Mm-hmm.
I swear it's almost cheaper to fly over to there and buy them and fly home than buy them in the United States.
It's true.
Wow. What do they cost here?
They're like $6 a marker.
Six to eight, yeah, depending on where you buy them.
For each marker and each individual marker?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
The thing, though, for me is the refill. The refill, because like I would buy Prismacolors over Copics, but because they're refillable, it's more cost effective. Because a refill costs you $8 as well, but I'll show you. Let me pull out a refill real quick. So this is what a refill looks like. That'll refill your like.
Say that again, dude. You came off again.
So. This refill will you know, refill your marker 10 or 15 times or more.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And so it is way cheaper to use these in the long run than it is to buy a $5 Prismacolor marker every freaking time. So.
How much did the refills cost?
$8.
Okay. Yeah, that's a lot cheaper. That's cheaper.
It does. It adds up. Yeah, it's more upfront cost, but you get more in the long run. The good thing, though, is you now can, because the tips are changeable, right?
Yeah.
So you can pull them out, put whatever tips you want in, but it comes with a chisel on one side, a brush on the other. But they make super tiny brushes, and they make another type of chisel tip now. So, yeah. Mm.
So. Well, and their brush is the best by far. Like, I've tried all the cheap ones. They're just, mm-hmm. they're quality through and through. They're worth it.
That's cool.
I you know what I do? I go to a Hobby Lobby, and if you have the Hobby Lobby app, you get 40% off one item. And I've gone into Hobby Lobby repeatedly, like 5 days in a row, to get the 5 markers I want.
Nice.
At 40% off.
That's good. That's not bad. Yeah.
Oh God. I'm the cheapest person alive.
I bought some off a used lot one time, so it wasn't bad.
If you can refill them and replace the nibs, it makes
correct, sense. Yeah. So buying them used ain't a bad idea either. You just plan on spending some money for the nibs and ink. So
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, guys, I think I'm done.
Oh, cool. Finish. Go back. There it is. All of its glory. Yeah, it looks great, man.
Yeah. I really appreciate you guys letting me hang out with you tonight. Thank you so much.
No, it's fun. It was nice meeting you and everything.
It was nice meeting you, buddy.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, definitely.
Cool. You would do that if you had a Hobby Lobby close to you, Abe? What do you got next to you? Do you got any stores?
Abe, I would do that. Yeah. Pete, yours looks great, dude. I love it. What'd you ink that with?
Brush. Ink.
Nice.
Brush.
No markers there, man.
Oh, you got a Michaels? Yeah. I'd buy a used lot off eBay, Abe. I would do that. And then order your refills off Amazon or something like that. So
cool. Yeah, there's mine. Mine's finished up. If anybody wants to buy it, let me know. So anyway, let's wrap it up.
Oh, yours looks great, Jeff. I didn't even see yours yet, man.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Came out okay. So let's see. Let's just go down the line. Let's everybody tell people like their websites, like where they can find them and all that kind of stuff. Brad, you go first.
You can reach me at pencilforlife.com. You can reach me at Twitter at pencilforlife. You can reach me on Instagram as pencil.for.life or pencilforlife on Facebook. I have them all. So.
Okay. And Justin, where's a good place to find you?
The best place to find me is at posemuse.com, or if you're on Tumblr, Pose Reference. And I'm also Pose Reference on Instagram.
Okay, great. Yeah. Yeah, send me those links in Facebook if you don't mind after the show, and I'll put them in the description under the show for people that watch this later, because a lot of people will show up tomorrow and stuff and watch this. And Flynn Jr., where can they find you besides on the screen right now?
Instagram.com/mflemjr. It's MFLEMJR. And that's probably the best place.
Cool.
Just Instagram, that's it?
That's it for now. I'm answering the question, Jeff.
Okay. You can find his store from that link. He's got a cool store and like lots of magnets and stuff up there. So I would suggest everybody search a little, but he just wants to go to Instagram. That's how it is.
Thanks, man.
So Pete, where can they find the ultimate Peter Palmiotti? The ultimate Aquaman artist of all fucking time.
The Indomitable Pete.
That's right.
I am everywhere on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Patreon, YouTube, Twitch, and other places. LinkedIn. Peter Palmiotti. Palmiotti.
Yeah. Soon to be Crazy Catman. Yep.
Ultimate Crazy Catman.
And then me, of course, with Jeff Lafferty. You guys are all on my channel, so you know where to find me. What's your website, Abe? Tell that in the chat. Actually, you can't because there's no thing. You can find Abe Sapin on Facebook, though, if you want to hunt him down. Yeah. All right, guys. Thanks for watching. It was a blast of a show. And thanks to everybody in the chat. See you guys next time.
See you guys.
See ya.